What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Game Over Greggy Show. I'm one of your hosts, Greg Miller, alongside the producer slash seducer, Nick Scarpino. Over there, the pure one, Tim Geddes. And the man having possibly the best week of his life, I imagine, Gary Whitta.
Thank you.
Gary Whitta, story by... That's your credit.
Co-story.
Yeah, John Knoll. Shout out to him, too.
And me.
And you. And the story we're talking about, Rogue One, a Star Wars story.
A Star Wars story.
Yeah.
See how that works?
Yeah, I do.
Story by Star Wars story.
How you doing? What's life like right
now?
Yeah,
first off, huge congratulations to you and the team. You guys absolutely killed this movie.
I'm sure the first thing you did last night was watch our reacts that went up at like 12:30 in the morning.
I did actually spot it this morning, and I wanted to have time to watch it because if these guys are like, you know, dumping on the movie, I'm not going to come over.
You get here and it turns out we hate Rogue One.
Ambush. I don't even know what, it's surreal. I honestly don't know what to do with myself. The last 48 hours have just been nuts.
And that's what we want to get into today with you, of course. Thank you so much for coming. Patreon supporters, of course, get the show early. It's getting to you late. We usually put it up Thursday night or Friday morning. We're putting it up Friday night because we're recording it on Friday. Gary was nice enough to come in, do the show, get it out as fast as we can to you. Of course, that's the rigmarole. Patreon.com/kindoffunny. Get it early. Or YouTube.com/kindoffunny, where you can get it day by day.
I think I still am a Patreon of you, I think. I think I still actually
And I expect that to be
money.
Going up. Going up now. These Rogue One Star Wars checks are coming in.
It's like, Gary, I kind of feel like you could probably afford to give me a little more now.
Yeah, I'm hitting you up on Patreon. A big thing, I mean, it's a week of big news for you, accolades and all this thing. You are now the most visited Kind of Funny Game Over Greggy Show guest. This is your third appearance. Yeah.
Third appearance.
This is
third.
Only because of volume, because I keep coming back.
Right. Well, that's how returning guests work. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Well, it's one way to achieve that, I guess, just through attrition. Just like keep doing
exactly. Yeah. We keep doing cool stuff. You know what I mean?
Forcing people to watch.
We had Aisha Tyler on. She's done nothing since. Career went nowhere.
This is my third. You said you've never had a guest come back for a third time.
Yeah, right.
And what can we learn from that, do you think?
One of us is insane. But we're not sure.
It seems like it. I mean, clearly you and Colin can't be in the same room.
They give you a shot, right?
Yeah.
They come back. Yeah, maybe not such a good experience, but they come back one more time and they think, you know, maybe it's getting better.
Yeah.
It ain't getting better.
No.
So they don't come back.
But
you know what? I got to say, this is my first time here at this new. It's just incredible.
Thank you.
I was feeling quite bitter. Because I was thinking, wow, you know, Gareth, the director of the movie, Gareth was on Jimmy Kimmel.
Ah.
And I'm coming over here and I'm doing this. I think, wow, like that really shows you like the gulf between a director and a writer on a movie.
But now
I'm here, I'm like, wow, this is almost like Kimmel. You're like on your way.
Now,
almost like Kimmel. I'm gonna put that as a box quote. Yeah.
We did bring holdovers from
Is this still edible?
No, I looked at the top. This is Gary Whitta's spotted dick that we forgot to eat last time. This went bad January 2016.
Surely that's just all the more reason to make a show out of
eating
it.
You gotta try it.
Sure, I guess. Then I still have this one too.
You have the
ambrosia.
Custard, and that's bad
Devin
too?
Custer.
That's
This went bad in September 2016.
So this is a shame because I guess the thing that we're known for is I bring you English delicacies to eat.
That's why
you've
been back for
a time. I don't have any this time.
Yeah,
I was gonna say, like, don't you still have the spotted dick? But it's bad.
Yeah, but you get a pass this time around.
Yeah, right.
Before you always come in, you're just here to bullshit. You wrote a book, all right, big deal. You know, you know all these different things.
You know what? I tell you something as well. I sold probably more copies of the book through my appearance on your show than I did in any other thing that I did. So that's great.
Here's what I want you to know. So recording on Friday, it did the midnight releases last night. Mm-hmm. I know it was a rocky one that not a lot of people went and saw Rogue One last night. I really think after this post on Patreon, come out of this and you're the number two or number one grossing movie of the weekend,
I'm hoping
us.
that this podcast finally gets the word out.
Yeah.
That there's people, a Star Wars movie
in
cinemas this weekend.
So
haven't seen a lot about that.
Yeah.
Not a lot about
it's
that.
Like Jimmy Fallon, I always love this line that he did on the first episode of his talk show. He came out and he said, and it's national, I don't know why this joke stuck with me. It's not that great. I like it. And it's National French Fry Week. Hopefully this will really help get the word out about French fries. I thought that was a good joke. And Star Wars, obviously they spend a lot of money and it's Star Wars, so people find it. And I don't think we have an awareness problem.
No, you're doing pretty good.
So let's just clarify. I don't need to be here at all.
No, you're just doing this because you're a best friend.
Out of the goodness of my friendship to you and, you know.
The audience, they've been good to you. You're paying it back to them too. Yeah. They were super, that's been the, I think, for me, one of the fun moments, like you're talking about, you sold so many copies of the book when you came on.
Uh-huh.
But people like legitimately love you. That's the reason you're back for a third one.
That's not it.
It is. The audience does. And the amount of the audience that I've seen tweet at you or include us for no reason at all of I just finished Rogue One and thank you so much and da-da-da. And they're talking to you because they know you.
Yeah, because you said I was coming on the show. And so that's good.
Yeah. So now you brought stuff too. What is all this?
I've got some stuff to give away. Do you want to do this now?
Yeah.
Feels whatever right. You want to do, yeah. Who are you giving it away to?
Like, you can, I mean, I'm giving it to you.
Okay.
And then you can do with it, I mean, you can wear it and keep it yourself if you want. But
or we can give it to them, you're saying?
Yeah, it might be nice to give it away.
Kevin's saying no?
Do you have a conduit, a model to give stuff away?
Oh, yeah.
We have a process to give things away, yes.
All right, so then great. You want me to give you some
stuff? Walk me through what you got here.
All right, so look, I pulled this. I wanted to bring you something. I pulled it together at the last minute. Now, I don't have any real cool stuff from the movie. Like Gareth. Gareth had... Can we talk about like things that are in them? First of all,
great question.
Do we assume that people have seen the movie?
I would say, I'd venture to guess that by like 99% of the Kind of Funny audience will have seen Rogue One by the time this posts Monday on YouTube. So right. If you're early, maybe hold off.
But let's also just say there may be spoilers.
Oh, that's what I'm saying. There's going to be 100% spoilers in this. Yeah. Okay. Sorry, right. Everybody. I'm not. Well.
Okay. So that said, all right, let's start with some. Like this is what I was able to. Like, so my point being.
Yeah.
Gareth, for example, has, for as a souvenir from the movie, he has the actual Death Star plans. He has the cartridge that she pulls
sure.
out of the thing.
What? Sure.
That's like, he has it. He has the actual prop. I don't have anything that cool.
They didn't give you the crystal? The necklace?
No, that would have been great, right? There was a point where I did you're in the Pinewood, in the prop room, and everything is there, like all this amazing stuff. Like the first time I saw that wooden chessboard, mm-hmm. the holographic chessboard, but the wooden characters. I was like, oh my God, this is amazing. Like that, when you see it up close, like, my God, it's like, that's so finely, beautifully sculpted and just perfect. Like everything in these movies, like even like, a lot of times when you work on movies and TV shows, like you see a prop or a costume up close, you go, oh, I can kind of see how it's kind of fake. On Star Wars movies, that's not like right up close. You go, oh my God, this is like real. Like there's so perfectly crafted and like they put so much attention to detail into it. But anyway, my point, I don't have anything good. but I have a few things. I thought this was kind of weird. So you remember how I used to hang out with the Giant Bomb and guys and before I moved, I graduated to you guys. So I used to do a thing where I would sit with Ryan Davis and Jeff Gerstmann and those guys. They would play video games and I would be on the couch and I would help them. And my thing was shoot that guy. Remember this?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I used to say shoot that guy. Like that was my pro tip. My Brady Games guy.
Putting all those years being a PC guy, running this magazine, that's what you learned. Shoot that guy.
After many years as a games journalist, if you see a guy in a video game, shoot him. You should probably shoot him. He's probably not your friend. He's probably going to shoot you if you don't shoot him first.
Yeah.
So shoot that guy. That became my thing. Yeah. And so at some point they made these t-shirts, which are now, you can't get these anymore.
No, these are limited edition.
Yeah. So they did this kind of this blockhead character.
Of course you have your iPhone because you are one of the biggest Apple people anyone's ever met in the world.
And you'll notice here that the shadow is kind of a little reference to the episode one poster.
Yeah.
The Darth Vader
foreshadowing.
Shadow, which in its own way, ended up being quite foreshadowy.
Yeah, yeah.
Because
yeah.
I ended up working on a movie with Darth Vader in it.
Yeah, yeah.
So I have some of these in different sizes.
Okay, thank you.
I'm happy to give to you. They were just cluttering up my house.
Oh, well, you say it like that, it sounds like we're goodwill, but okay.
So this is going in order. I'm going to hide this over here because it's the coolest thing I'm going to say for last.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, so this is kind of cool. So this is
this is awesome.
She started an Etsy store recently and she makes and sells stuff. She's got a little crafty business.
Give the pin.
I should plug it.
Yeah, you should.
It's called Scotty and Min. So Scotty _MIN. And I don't remember what she called it that, but she sells, you know, little t-shirts and things and she's crafty and, you know, it's going well. It's good. And she made this. So this is a pizza destroyer. It's a slice of pizza. Pepperoni pizza that's also a Star Destroyer. I don't know how well you can see that.
Oh, Sky Cam. You put it right here. Lay it over here. We go to the top cam.
So.
Other way around.
Like this?
Yeah, because then it'll be right side up for
everyone. All right, okay.
Kevin doesn't have the technology to rotate cameras. There you go. See? Okay, look at that.
Oh, that's really great. Okay, so here's the cool thing about this, though. This is a Pablo Hidalgo original. Do you know who Pablo Hidalgo is?
No, I sound like I should know that name.
You should, and you're going to. So Pablo is a member of the what they call a story group at Lucasfilm.
Okay.
He's one of the guys who keeps it all together and makes sure that anything that happens in the TV show doesn't contradict what's in the movies. And that's why one of the reasons why like cool little Easter eggs from Star Wars Rebels and Clone Wars are in Rogue One. Pablo is the guy who kind of makes sure that all
is in fits continuity and works
canon. And he is just like, he's the guy, like if you ever had like, if aliens landed on Earth and said, right, we're going to do Star Wars trivia for the fate of the human race, Pablo is the guy you would put up.
Sure.
right? He's the guy. I don't know anyone in the world who's more knowledgeable about
I feel like they would have enslaved him to make the trivia, though.
Let's not go. Like,
okay, sorry, my bad. You're the writer. What am I saying?
That's a good point, but let's not go down that tangent. I had my wife and I had pizza with Pablo and his wife recently, and he sketched this little thing on a box, and we liked it, and so we scanned it in, and we made it made
a T-shirt.
So you
just stole his art, and now you're making money off of it.
Yes, and we're going to sell it on the Etsy store, but a portion of the proceeds from the sale of the shirts are going to go to a local dog rescue charity that Pablo supports.
Okay.
So
there you go.
See,
full circle.
You got ahead
full
of yourself, circle. And you realize it was actually cool.
I just want to nail you.
But I have this one. I have this one to give away.
Awesome.
All right.
Yeah.
You want to hear? You want the coolest part?
Yes.
I don't know if this is actually cool or not, but this is the only thing I was able to get from the movie.
From Rogue One.
Actual thing from the film that I'm going to give to you.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
So, and maybe it's lame, but I don't know.
It's not lame. I can tell you already, it's not lame.
So, third act of the movie. Scarif, the Imperial base, is a big battle on the beach,
awesome.
Big Saving Private Ryan kind of battle on the beach. All right, so this is actual sand from Scarif.
Oh, it's so coarse and it gets
awesome.
Everywhere.
This is the yes, right? Don't you just hate sand?
Yeah,
it gets everywhere. this is real sand that where I was on the beach at Scarif, which is actually a place called Bovingdon in southern England, and I think they also shot in like somewhere tropical. But I was there when I was on set. I was on Scarif for a while, and I remember thinking they're not going to give me anything good. So I just scooped some sand up into a jar.
That's awesome.
Yes,
bro.
And this is some of it. I emptied out a little bit, and I'm giving it to you
to give to them
to give to whoever you want.
Thank you so
that's
much.
Like
oh, here,
that's
Sky
a real piece of a Star Wars planet right there.
That is amazing.
Yeah,
and I assume this is in a real vanilla bean jar you used at your house.
Yes.
You used all
that's
this vanilla bean.
We used all of it. We had to eat a lot of vanilla just to free up the jar to bring you this sand.
Well, we thank you very much for that. That's awesome.
So, again, I don't know if that's a cool thing or
that's
not.
Awesome.
Like,
that's totally awesome.
That's what I have. So
I
you can organize whatever giveaway for these items as you see fit. That's my gift to you.
Thank you.
Come here.
Congratulations.
My first instinct is I'm like, I want to put that on the set.
I know.
But
we can take a little bit.
Guys, we can go to any Safeway and get the vanilla bean organic jar and just send them that. They won't know.
Just do what drug dealers do. Get some regular sand and cut it.
There you go.
That's true. That's good. Or just keep this and put
go to the hardware store, get some regular sand, put a little bit in there.
Yeah.
Nailed it.
It's like people are going like, it doesn't feel as Star Wars-y as I thought it would. It's not giving that 90% earth sand.
Yeah. It's from Ocean Beach.
So I want to get into Star Wars stuff. I have something to say to you.
Some news?
Yes, some news. It's a congratulation to you.
Thank
because
you.
Obviously this thing is amazing. Love the movie. First off, how cool is it that there are a ton of people out there saying this is their favorite Star Wars movie ever? Coming after the prequels, coming after a lot of issues, coming after all the talk of people. There's true Star Wars fans that are saying this is Star Wars.
It's really quite overwhelming. And I should preface anything I'm going to say by first of all saying like it's really... It's in a way almost uncomfortable for me to my social feed and everything's kind of melted down in the last 48 hours. And I really tried to make a point as I'm going to now and when I respond to people on Twitter and Facebook to say like, I'm just a teeny tiny piece of this film.
Sure.
I'm one of several writers that worked on the film. It takes 15 minutes for the credits to roll. A lot of people work on this film. And obviously Gareth and Kathy and all the producers and the cast and crew and everyone that animates all the droids and everything is like, it's just a vast, vast effort. And so, and my piece of it, I'm incredibly proud to be a piece of it, but just a small piece. And I always try to make that point that I'm just a small piece, but it is, the single greatest privilege of my life to be a part of this film and Star Wars history. Cause that's what it is now. I honestly don't know what to do with myself. I did two movies before this that, you know, maybe some people saw and maybe some people didn't. Book of Eli and After Earth.
Yep.
So in some cases, maybe better if you didn't see it. it's weird. Like I said, it's weird. Your career as a screenwriter goes from like, I remember there were many years when I was trying to break in and like you meet someone at a party. Oh, I'm a screenwriter. Oh, really? What have you written? And you're nothing.
I'm working on it.
Yeah, I'm working on it. But people are like, you're not, you know, unless you've actually done something that's made, like how are you a real screenwriter? But like for many years, that's the struggle. Somebody told me once a great answer for that. If someone says to you, like you're a screenwriter, haven't anything made. And someone says, have you written anything I would have seen? The correct answer is, I don't know. What have you seen?
Smart.
Right?
Put it on them. Make them the asshole.
Bit of a dick move, but, you know, again.
Pro maneuver.
A lot of screenwriters are dicks, so it comes very naturally.
They are.
So I went through years of that to then saying, oh, I wrote a movie called The Book of Eli with Denzel Washington. And people go, oh, and some people go, oh, I've seen that. Or some people say, oh, I've heard of it. Or some people haven't seen it. The weirdest thing about this one is working on something that you know that everyone will see. Everyone in the world is going to see this movie. And like I said, the reaction to it, and not just the fact that everyone's going to see it, but it's something that's so special to so many people, right? I mean, Star Wars really genuinely means something to our generation and to, you know, new kids coming up, and it's really amazing. I was at a screening last night, and
when you say screening, this is what I mean. I follow you; we're friends. So you say screening, you mean you went and bought a ticket to go see your movie?
I was
in
at a Century. Went to a Century Theater. I wanted to see it with a real paying crowd.
Yeah,
and it was organized by a bunch of friends. They bought like a ton. They basically bought out almost the entire theater, but they're all legit. Hardcore Star Wars, like mostly I think game industry people and friends of friends, but like they were all like super hardcore Star Wars nerds, and that's the audience that I wanted to see it with. You saw it at the premiere, and the premiere is great, but there's a lot of kind of posers and, you know, celebs and, you know, kind of people that just want to go to a movie premiere. I wanted to see it with like our people,
sure,
like the nerds, the ones that got bullied at school, like though, and like Star Wars for them was like their escape, people like me, and I wanted to see it with those guys. And it was the biggest thrill of my life to sit there. Like, it's the second time I've seen it. So what you do is, first time you watch the movie, the second time you watch the audience watch the movie, and you watch for those reactions. And when little moments happen, whether it's like a twist or a reveal or an Easter egg or a familiar character shows up, and you watch that kind of, that little ripple goes through the audience, and you get a chill. You go, oh, shit, that's so cool. And afterwards, people were, you know, coming up and like hugging me. And people literally like crying, like emotional. Like, really, like just so, because it's like, it's Star Wars, and it's the Star Wars that we grew up with. It's the original trilogy. It's like, you know, the movie takes place literally like 48 hours before A New Hope. I mean, it's right there in that zone. So it's the Star Wars that my generation grew up with. I've said before, it's the most expensive Star Wars fan film ever made.
Yeah,
in a
and
way.
It feels like that.
That's exactly what it is. And that, you know, and that's, you know, because George sold it, and it kind of opened the door for other filmmakers to come along, and it started with J.J., who's, you know, roughly the same age as me. That's where it started, right? This generation of filmmakers that grew up watching A New Hope and Empire, and go, I want to do that. I want to make that for a living. Whatever it is that I'm feeling right now, I want to make people feel like that. Mm-hmm. And that's how I started, when I watched those movies. And now we're all grown up, and Star Wars is now in the hands of, you know, Disney and Lucasfilm, and they've invited other filmmakers to come in and play. So we get to make the movies now. So they are in a weird way. They're just very expensive canonical fan films, but they're coming from a place of people who, like me, froze their Han Solo figure in the freezer and freeze them in carbonite. And
naturally,
Gareth, who dragged his girlfriend to Tunisia to drink blue milk, you know, for his birthday because that's what he wanted to do. You know, these are like the hardcore fans, and to be able to contribute a piece of it, and then see how that. Like I said, how I want to make other people feel like that. And I saw it last night. I saw people coming out of the theater feeling that way. I got choked up. And again, saying it, even just me as a tiny piece of it, just knowing that this movie has the power to have that effect on people, like kids and grown-ups and people of all ages. It was magic. It's just pure magic.
Magic, I think, is really the best way to explain it. There was a point in the movie where, when I saw it the first time, where it was a.
You've seen it more than once?
Twice now.
Oh, good for you.
Halfway through, I looked over at Kevin and I was like, this movie's fucking awesome. And from the moment after that, like the last 40 minutes of the movie, it was just pure magic. And one of the coolest things
everyone talks about the last 40 minutes. And then the last five.
Oh, my God. the last 40 was the magic was there. Magic is the right word.
And isn't it cool? It's exhausting, right? Like, and even the first time I saw it, I know everything that's going to happen in the film. And I'm sitting there like, are they going to get away? What's going to happen? Are they going to live? Are they going to die? Like, you get caught, you cannot help get caught up in it. It's amazing.
But my favorite thing about it, though, and going back to the fan film thing, going back to the magic, is years ago, before, like, when we knew you were writing a Star Wars movie, you came on the show and we were talking, the topic was Star Wars.
Yeah, this has been going on for years, right? It takes a long time to make a movie.
Yeah, and you were here and we were talking and the topic was Star Wars and what's our favorite Star Wars, I think was the topic.
And real quick, was that before we knew? Because I remember, I mean, I've been around you. It was Cloak and Dagger for so long.
I don't know if it even, at that point, even, you'd have to go back and look if it even announced, like, what the film
exactly.
was.
We didn't. There was rumors that it was the heist to get the thing.
There was a space between it being announced that I was working on it and then the reveal that it was the Death Star story.
Yeah, because that was the whole thing.
We didn't know that.
Because I remember remember that being sorry for this quick aside, but I love the cloak and dagger nature that we finally found out. But I'll never forget when you were telling me about it or whatever. And I don't remember if it was on a show or we were just talking somewhere else. But you're like, when you got you'd been waiting, and they finally sent you like the pitch or whatever for what you'd be, and you had to sign up, and you got it, and you were like, this went to the wrong person. This can't be what I was working.
They sent it to me. Yeah. I still think they felt embarrassed taking it back. They're like, well, shit, you've seen it now. Better let him do it. But yeah, it's.
Sorry, I derailed.
So what was awesome is you came and we're talking about Star Wars and we're talking about our favorite Star Wars movies, and you were saying that my favorite thing in all of Star Wars is the end of Return of the Jedi.
Oh my god!
When there's the three plane scene going on, where there's the space battle, there's the Endor, there's the Luke and the Emperor in the
see a little bit of that in Rogue One, did
going
you?
That, and then as right. I'm seeing it happen, I got so much chills watching it because it's like my first instinct was this is amazing. My second instinct was, this is the Star Wars magic that I thought I would never get again after watching Force Awakens and having that first like, this is happening and this is good.
Right.
But I got it again. And then there was that third level of like, this is what Gary was talking about a long time ago. And that's so fucking cool.
Yeah,
like, it's so cool that it's just like, I don't know. Because the end of Jedi is amazing. And this, it's like,
I'm going to say it again. Perfect. Jedi, for some reason, people give it grief, Ewoks or whatever it is. I will defend it to the day I die. And particularly that third act, the editing between the battle in space, the battle around the bunker on the ground, and then, you know, kind of the personal battle between Luke and Vader and the Emperor. The way those three pieces are cut together and they all kind of inform each other, you know, the shield goes, you know, they drop the shield, so now they can go inside the Death Star. And then, you know, they hit the reactor, so Luke's got to get Vader, you know, got to get him out of there, and, you know, he saves his son. And like the way all the pieces kind of connect together, like, the first time I saw it as a kid, like, I blubbed like a baby, just overwhelmed by the emotion and the spectacle of it all. And certainly, yeah, I mean, you know, that's, you know, Gareth has parts of Star Wars that he loves. I have parts that I love. Chris and Tony and John, all the other people, that writers that worked on it, all bring a little bit of their, like, this is what I love about Star Wars and this is what I want to bring. And, you know, certainly the kind of the interconnected, you know, back and forth ground and space nature of the battle at the end of Rogue One is, there's some Jedi influence in there for sure.
Yeah, and there's definitely some stuff in there that you're like, okay, I know, I kind of understand how this is gonna, you know, boil down, how everything's gonna happen. And then I guess we're spoiling shit.
We're spoiling.
When the Corvette, the Hammerhead Corvette pushes the destroyer into the, oh my god, I was like, come on, dude, that is the best fucking way to break that shield. Let's go, son.
Because there's a perfect example for me to do what I love to do and say, that's not me. And that was a different writer that added that. I wrote the original version of the space battle, but then all the little logistics, like I say, each writer comes on and adds little things that, you know, I think I had like a Star Destroyer crash in my version, but then they found another writer comes on and goes, you know what would be cooler? Do it this way.
Yeah.
And then they keep adding and keep making it better.
But so that's the thing that I like so much about it, right? It was like, you guys talk about the end of Return of the Jedi. We had three movies to care about those characters, right? We had three movies to care about the fate of them.
Yeah.
This one, you guys were able
to
do. You
only get one shot at it, 2 hours.
You guys were able to do this within 2 hours. And not only that, you were able to make us care about characters that you go into knowing pretty well that they're not, it's not going to turn out so well for them.
Did you think that?
I assumed that. I wanted that.
You didn't think they were going to get away?
No, I wanted their journey to kind of end there. You know, when you saw them talking to each other and you saw that they've basically had their entire lives taken away from them and this is their one shot to sort of redeem that.
Do something worthwhile.
Yeah. And I liked, and the character dynamics for me really good. And I think Diego Luna and Felicity Jones,
they're great.
Like, they're great, right?
Acting, I mean, like,
good chemistry between them, but also just the right amount, right? They were still aloof from each other the entire time until that last scene, until that last moment.
There's a moment where they're coming down in the elevator at the end. It's beautiful. Yeah.
And a lot of people kind of look at that as a romantic moment. I didn't. I looked at that as sort of like we finally kind of, this is it. We did it. We understand each other.
Yeah, it's camaraderie.
We're the same person. Yeah. It's camaraderie, right?
Yeah.
And there is a mutual affection there, but it's also the mutual affection knowing that you're about to get hit by a nuclear blast and that's it for you.
But, it's like, you know, one of the things I remember, one of my favorite moments in movies is when Maximus dies at the end of Gladiator. Mm-hmm. And it's okay that he dies because he's done the one thing that he was still around, basically the only thing he was staying alive to do, which was kill Commodus.
Right.
And get revenge for his family so he can be reunited with them. It's a beautiful death. Like, it's almost not, like, you cry, it's beautiful, but you're not sad. It's like the right ending for the character.
Mm-hmm. But kudos to the team for allowing that to happen, right? Because you don't see that in this day and age with a lot of movies, especially a lot of movies that we're hoping have more iterations, right? Mm-hmm. With Rogue One, obviously, you can't really, like, the natural sequel is, of course, you know, A New Hope. Like,
I mean, it's one of the benefits, and not just in Star Wars, but one of the benefits of, like, a self-contained story that doesn't have to be part of, like, an ongoing thing is your characters can...
But I can understand.
They can have an end point.
I can understand sitting around a table, though, as a group of producers and executive producers thinking, like, do we want these? Like, these are going to be characters that we love. Can we utilize them somewhere else? It's not to say we can't ever see them again. Obviously, if we do, if God forbid, there's more prequels that happen, they can come back. But they're not going to be, like, we're not going to see an old Jyn Erso. We're just not going to see that.
But, you know, and again, it's interesting. They will, you know, they might, there's like, Jyn's got this really, I find it fascinating, that gap that when she was with Guerrero.
Right. Like, what were those? So there's stuff like that could happen.
So, then, yeah, I mean, sure. And again, they have this, that doesn't have to be a film. That could be a novel, a comic book, TV series. Sure. There's all kinds of different ways they fill in those blanks in all kinds of interesting ways. Yeah.
But I mean, you know, and again, kudos to you guys because she felt like a real character and she felt like an original character, and there's been a lot of characters in Star Wars and a lot of characters we've seen lately. And she just, I mean, she nailed it.
Like, yeah, Felicity's so good. She's so good in the film.
I mean, that's what I felt like, you know, that all the characters felt original. I didn't, you know what I mean? Watching it, I wasn't getting vibes of, I mean, there's vibes, but in terms of like the new droid K or whatever, right? Like,
I love him.
He's awesome.
He's everyone's favorite droid now. Like,
oh, yeah, totally.
You know, it's an amazing thing. I tell you one thing. One of the things I liked Force Awakens, but there are particular things that I really liked. And one of them was, you know, because again, that's tough. I think JJ had the toughest job of all, right? Like, back in. Mm-hmm. Right, and mm-hmm. you've got to kind of like
the reset,
you know, and like again, my personal read on it, the very first line that any character says in the film
this will begin
to make things right. And I don't know for sure, but my read is like, oh, that's JJ kind of saying like, we're back,
let's heal,
yeah. And one of the things I give him credit for, and this is incredible, he created a droid. And him, ILM, and everyone else that worked on it created a droid as iconic as R2-D2 and as well loved, like right out of the gate. Like, people love BB-8 right away. And it's kind of crazy. I didn't see it. I mean, I always knew he was always one of my favorite characters, but I didn't know people were going to freak out for K the way that K2SO is. Like, people coming to me last night saying he's my favorite droid now. I was like, okay. I mean, there's some good droids in Star Wars, but the fact that he's now a lot of people's favorite and Meatly is amazing.
Well, he was, again, it's, and you know, I mean this in every sense of the way as a compliment. You were able to give us just enough familiarity for us to be like, okay, it's a droid. We get that. We get what this is going to be. This is sort of the old school buddy droid to the hero. And then take it a step further with this one being kind of an asshole the entire time.
And be a droid that, at least for me, I don't think we ever see, right?
Right.
He hits the guy and he's talking back. And like that fucking scene where he's, oh yeah, I should have stayed on the ship, whatever. And they throw the grenade and he just catches it and tosses it back.
Yeah, that was
like,
awesome.
Fucking yes.
And it was comic relief that worked. And I think that's the most important thing is because like he was the Jar Jar of this movie, except done right, you know? And that's the good thing is like, this is how it should have been, right?
That's the thing of why, like, I mean, I'm excited to see it again because for me I felt it all fell into place when we're in the last 40 minutes like we're talking about, like when that starts, and that's when I was like, oh, I see how it's all working together and who they are, and this is awesome, Bob, and their deaths meant something to me. So I want to go back, of course, to now know more about them from the beginning, be more invested as like I know who everybody's going to be and who they are and how their relationship is. But then to hear the lines that come after every K-line, because he would say stuff and our theater would erupt.
Yeah.
And you see Miles moving around, I'm like, I don't know what they're saying.
It's one of those movies where you've almost got to... I spoke to Anthony Daniels at the premiere, who plays C-3PO, and you know, he just has that one moment in the movie. And I said, how cool that you're in, like, you're in the film, that, you know, you're in this, even though you might not expect to see those characters because it's not a saga film, how great that 3PO and R2 are in the film. And he said, yeah, the only bummer for me is like when people see me, they cheer so much, they don't get to hear my line. and it's true. And we went and twice now, I've seen the film. You can barely hear what he says because as soon as people see him, it just erupts. And, you know, I guess testament to the popularity of those characters.
100%.
But yeah, it might be like however many weeks it is down the road, we can finally go see the movie in a half empty theater or you get it on Blu-ray. They'll actually hear every because there's so many little cues. A lot of the Easter eggs in the film are audio Easter eggs, like just a little something in the background that you hear.
Yeah, what were you talking about? You were talking about Easter eggs for like Rebels and all these different... What are some of the ones that stand out to you?
That's not for me to tell you.
God damn it. They're Easter eggs, Greg.
Yeah, I know.
There's so many. There's so many like cool things that I noticed in watching it a second time. I was just like, there is even more, and I'm sure there'll be a ton of list videos in the line and stuff. And that's the type of stuff I don't want to spoil. If I want you to have your own moments, because I think those are the really cool things.
Finding the Easter eggs is fun, and like again, it's one of the reasons why I think a movie like that is great to go back and see again. And I'm talking to people I've already seen it like 3 or 4 times. It's not, it technically only opens tonight, right? Just from previews, like people have seen it 3 or 4 times already.
Yeah. How many more times do you expect to see it?
I've seen it twice now. I'm seeing it again tonight, again on Monday. And I'm seeing it with my wife's family over the holidays. Nice. So that'll be five. So cool. Maybe that's enough.
Sure.
Maybe.
But we'll the nice see. Again, no. The first time you're sitting there, right? Again, even someone like me who knows everything that's going to happen in the film before it happens, I'm sitting there. The premiere is my first time seeing it finished. All the wires.
Had
and
you
CG
seen stuff beforehand,
removed.
Though? I'd
seen bits and pieces. Okay. I'd not really seen like a complete cut of it. I'd seen, and everything that I'd seen was like CG's not finished, or you know, sure. You can still see the wires or whatever, or doesn't have final soundtrack. So at the premiere was the first time I saw the finished, complete, you know, pristine film. And again, even knowing what's going to happen before it happens, I'm sitting there like as a fan, just being like, I was sitting next to Chris Weitz, who's one of the other writers in the film, and we were just like this.
Yeah.
Like honestly the whole time, like we were just geeking out big time. Like, so here's a minor spoiler, minor Easter egg. You know, I knew they were in there, but I didn't know how they were going to do it. The first time I saw Red Leader and Gold Leader in the movie, I lost my shit. I was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
They did that? It's just amazing. Again, a lot of this stuff, you don't know what they're doing. Like, I knew those characters were in the film, but I didn't know, is it going to be someone that looks like the guy? Is it going to be this? Is it going to be that? And they found a way to do it that is just, again, magic. Like, it belongs in the film. It's just incredible how they do that.
They're going back to something. You hung out with C-3PO. How was the premiere? How was all working on the movie? What the hell?
The premiere was... outside of the birth of my daughter is probably the most amazing night of my life. And maybe even better, because the birth of my daughter was like really traumatic as well. It was like 52 hours in labor for my wife. Yeah. And I was like, oh my God, doing
a lot
my
of crying
head
happening there.
Whereas the premiere was just like nothing but just like good times, just like having so much fun. And it was huge. I mean, they blocked off like 4 square blocks and they parked a giant life-size X-Wing in the middle of Hollywood Boulevard.
That.
It was
awesome.
I've done, again, been to premieres before. I've never seen anything like this. It was just an order of magnitude. Like Star Wars, there's nothing else in the world even close to it. And it was just epic. And meeting, I don't even know where to start. I've got so many funny stories. I just joined Annie Daniels. It was so cool to meet him. And my wife was there as well. And we were talking for like 2 minutes. And I said, do you know who this is? This is C-3PO. And she went, oh my God. Cause she loves the droids and she loves 3PO. And those are her characters that she likes. You know, that's her thing. Like she loves those characters. For me, I got to meet a lot of cool people. I got completely tongue tied. And like, again, kind of emotional was meeting Lawrence Kasdan, who wrote Empire and Jedi and Force Awakens and Raiders of the Lost Ark and basically almost every film that made me want to do this for a living. I was like, I spotted him and I was like, and I just said it really loudly. Oh my God, that's Lawrence Kasdan. And he looked around and I just wandered over to him. And the nice thing about being a premiere for something you worked on, I went up to so many famous people that normally I would not dare go up to.
Sure.
And I said, look, usually I wouldn't have the balls to do this, but I co-wrote this movie, so I feel like I have a free pass to say hello to you. And they all went, oh, and they gave me, they were all just so happy and nice to talk to. And Lawrence and I went over and talked to him. And I said, you're the movies that you wrote, the work that you did, is like, it's why I do what I do. And I got choked up. I couldn't help myself. That was my favorite. It was Lawrence Kasdan.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
So then afterwards, you posted about Kevin Smith. Kevin Smith came up to you?
Up to Kevin. And Kevin was one of my, so he was standing there and on the red carpet. And I love Kevin Smith. I think he's great. And I also know that he's one of a genuine fan, right? He's not one of these posers like, oh, I'm a geek. Yeah, whatever. You know, what Biggs is second name? Do you know? No. But Kevin, I bet you could tell you. Because these guys like live and breathe this stuff. And I did the thing. I went up and I said, yeah, it's funny because it takes me a minute to say it and you see it change. I said, hi, Kevin. I usually wouldn't do this. And he's had that interaction a million times, mm-hmm. right? And you can see him kind of being, because he's lovely and he's very polite, but you can see the like, here we go again. And I said, but I was one of the writers of the film, so I feel like it's okay for me to talk to you. And he just instantly went, and just came in and gave me a big hug, and he was so happy, and I had a nice chat with him, and it was like, are you excited for the film? And he's like, are you fucking kidding, dude? Yeah, I'm so excited. And then I saw him again at the party after. I said, you have to tell me, before the film, you have to tell me what you think of the film afterwards. He goes, yeah. And I spotted him, and I went over, and I tapped him on the shoulder, and I turned around and just went, like, well? And he just kind of came in and gave me this like huge, like beefy bear hug thing. Yeah. And it was awesome. And I had a similar experience with Will Wheaton, who loved it as well. And Chris Hardwick and all the kind of like the geekerati were at the premiere. Sure. And again, I usually would not be permitted or feel...
You wouldn't want to come up to these people at a random party.
Like, you don't want to be one of those guys. But again, like it was the one night in my life where I could walk up to anyone and say, you know what, I'm going to talk to you.
Yeah,
and
you're at my party.
You're in my house. that I got to do that, and I got to do that with a lot of people that, you know, the cast people I'd met. You know, I had met Felicity and Diego and Alan and various people who worked on the movie when I was on the set briefly. But there are others that I had never met Mads, so I just like walked up to Mads and just said, "Hi, Mads."
How cool is he in real life? Because he seems like one of the coolest people.
One of the nicest, most gracious people I've ever met. Really? At the after party, it was fairly late, and everyone had had a few drinks. He knew who I was because I'd introduced myself on the red carpet, and I wandered over to him. It started to get late, and people were starting to filter out. And it was kind of cool because the whole thing was like decked out, like all this kind of rebel stuff. And they had a massive, like illuminated Death Star blueprint on the back of the wall. And I don't know if he did this deliberately, but he was sitting under it. And he just said, like, see that? I built that.
That's awesome.
And I went over to him, and everyone was just like on such a high because the film was so good. And everyone was just like so happy and so relieved and still on that kind of that. You come out of a movie like that, it's like on a carpet of air, right? You're just so energized. Oh, man, that was so good. And everyone's so happy. And like, you know, it's the end of, you know, I worked on it for about a year. Gareth, you know, for, you know, three times that long. And everyone's just so exhausted and so like, ugh, by the end of the film. So we finally actually get it out there and it's good. It's like such an epic sense of relief. And you're just so happy and elated that it was like just the vibes in the room. Everyone was just like, oh, and like you can tell like the Disney stuff, like Bob Iger and Alan Horn were like, yeah. Like everyone feels like the movie's gonna be good. And so I went over to Mads and I was like, can you, like, isn't this amazing? Like, we did this thing and, like, you're the guy that built the Death Star. Like, how cool is that? And he just sat there for a second and he kind of went like this, like, come in for a second.
Mads called you over. That's awesome.
Just like, just leaning close and he was like, we made a Star Wars. And I was like, yeah, we did.
And that's, I mean, like, so to go back to normal life, you're driving over here, you're driving through San Francisco. Is that in your head all the time of like, I fucking made a Star Wars?
I mean, now it is because everything's happening right now, right? And mm-hmm. But you have to remember, I haven't worked on the movie since January of 2015. That's when I was done on the film.
Yeah.
So I've written three films since then and like a bunch of TV pilots and I had a book that came out and like the movie kept going on without me. But I had moved on to other things and almost kind of forgotten about it. It was, Star Wars, that's coming out. And so now to have it all kind of come back, it's like a bunch of memories and, you know, emotions and it was all worth it.
I suppose it's just how it is to be a screenwriter. Was it hard for you to be like, all right, my job's done and now you guys are going to go start making memories as you make the film and you're
In a way, it's part of, you know, you understand that as a screenwriter, there is you're a bit like a, and this is not just Star Wars, but any film, really. Unless you're also directing or producing, you're kind of like a party planner. And you sit in a, you know, when I posted a picture a while ago of like the room that Gareth and I started in when we first started working on developing John's story. And it's this very unglamorous room. Like, just looked like something from like Dunder Mifflin. This is a very boring room. And you don't really think like doesn't feel like Hollywood or, you know, a galaxy far, far away at all. But then, you know, you get to, you know, where you are now, where you're standing next to an X-Wing and you go, oh shit, like this is all real. But my part of the movie, unless you're also the writer that's writing all the way through production, you know, there's a point where on every film I kind of, you know, help plan the party. So you're going to do all this fun stuff and you're going to go to these planets and you're going to do this and that and you're going to blow this up and this is going to happen. And then you give it to the guys that actually go make it, and they go, right, bye, you're done. We're going to go actually have the party now.
Right.
And, you know, that's, I want to go to the party. Can I come?
Like, no, we don't need you anymore.
So like, they didn't need me on set, but like, they couldn't keep me away. Like, I mean,
I feel like the one thing that would have made the movie better is if you were just on the planets, just, you know, with them.
I was
there for a week as a personal guest of Gareth, because we became very good friends during the movie. And I was just there. So there's no way I'm not visiting that set. Are you kidding
That's
me?
That's great. That's great.
And Chris did this. Chris was the same thing. He was like, I'm going. And so we just went. We just showed up.
Your suitcases in hand.
But I mean, obviously you would never do this, but how hard is it to see that and be like, I have to watch. There's no, you can't say anything. You can't be like, that's not, no, you know.
You don't really think it, and you're just so happy to be there.
Yeah.
And you're,
I mean, traditionally for people who don't know, like the writer, you would probably not get that invite if you weren't, you know.
If you're not the writer that's like actively working on the movie, then
there's no reason for you to be there.
There's no reason for you to be there, other than, you know, if they're gracious enough to invite you, which they were. You're just there as an observer. Mm-hmm. And, you know, at that point you already know the movie's in good hands. These people know what they're doing. You know, I'm just happy now. It's a relief in a way to just be able to sit and watch it happen.
So the first time you're on set, was that on the beach during the beach weekend?
No, it was Yavin 4.
Yavin 4,
the Rebel base. It was the first set I was on.
What's like, to walk us through that, what's the first thing you see there?
I walked onto the set, and it's that big round table with the green screens around it.
So that's awesome. It's like
I walked
room.
Onto that set, which they recreated perfectly from 1977, and it was I almost cried. It was like that really is, being there.
You told a story last time you were on, I think, or maybe it was the first time you were on. You've been on so many times, it's hard to track that now. Of when you were doing the Book of Eli, and Denzel Washington came up to you and said, you did all this? Like, can you believe that this is all from you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And that was even more surreal, because that was my first time being on a set of something I had written. And Denzel was, he came over and he's like, your words are coming alive, Gary. How does it feel? And I'm just like, oh, get back to you. I don't know. It's like, it doesn't sink in.
Right.
It still hasn't sunk in. Not on Star Wars. It still hasn't sunk in.
That's crazy.
So what? I know it still hasn't sunk in, but like what I mean, I love about you in general, but about in the Star Wars, you know, crossing of paths here is what a big fan you are. And I loved the fact that you continued to be a big fan of the project you made and then passed off and all those things, to where following you on Twitter, the genuine joy you had anytime the Rogue One stuff started to appear.
Yeah.
There's photos of you buying armful of toys for characters that, even if they weren't your idea necessarily, even though I imagine most were, so to some extent, they're part of this thing you made happen.
I went to, they had this thing last year for Force Awakens called Force Friday, which is summertime in September, was where they like released all the toys, and they made a big deal. You can go get, the toys and the ships from the movie for the first time. And it's like a scrum of people at Target and Walmart getting these toys. And they did they didn't make as big a deal out of it for Rogue, but they did a similar day where the toys, there was a day that the toys had dropped. And it's like, I'm going to Target. I'm going to get some shit. And there's a mall here that has a Target and a Disney store, and they have some of the best stuff, like Disney store exclusives. And a Hot Topic, which usually I would not go in a Hot Topic, but they had but there were certain like Funko bobble
Funko
guys
Pops,
you could only get at Hot Topic, so I had to go in the Hot Topic. And so I did. I went to three different stores, and almost got into a fight over with a guy in the aisle for like the last K2SO. And I was this close to pulling the "Do you know who I am?" shit, but I was like, I'm never going to do that. I'd never get over feeling like a dick doing that. But he was, in the end, he gave it. Actually, you know what? I remember now. We found out there were two. So it was like, okay, there's a second one. Yeah. I went and bought, I just bought every toy. I couldn't help myself.
Did you leave a mint on card, or did you open them up?
Did I what?
Leave a mint on card, or did you take them out of the package?
No, I took it. I don't do that. Toys are meant to be played with.
Sure.
I don't understand people that buy toys and keep them in boxes. It's like keeping a bird in a cage or something. Like, these things are meant to spread their wings and fly. You're supposed to play with toys.
Exactly.
You got to freeze them.
Yeah, I'm gonna freeze them in carbonite. I still have some that are still in boxes, because I bought like multiples of certain things.
Sure.
To give to people as gifts, or I guess, if you I wouldn't do this for like something super expensive, but like the little ones, like I bought a gin that I kept in the box, and one that I took out to, play with gin and Krennic, like going like that. Didn't you used to do that?
Oh, yeah. Smash them together? Yeah. Are you kidding me? Please.
Also, like, my toys were all-inclusive, too, so I have, like, Green Lantern in there as well. It didn't matter. It didn't matter if it was Darth Vader versus Superman or whatever.
Green Lantern, you know, he could get over there.
For some reason, I had a Green Lantern that was my favorite toy. I had no idea where I got it.
That was the great thing about toys is that actually almost kind of happening in movies is, like, you know, Green Lantern and, you know, Doctor Strange.
Crossovers.
That's what it is now, yeah. I saw an interesting thing on Twitter. Someone was talking about, they tweeted out that, I guess, when the original Star Wars came out, they didn't have enough toys to sell, so they sold cards that was like a certificate, a voucher for that you bought the toy, and then you can come back in when they had it.
Yes, Chris Weitz has one of those.
Really?
The original Star Wars toys from 1977, they were so... What happened was, if you remember the history, nobody knew that Star Wars was going to blow up. Yeah. It opened on like a handful of screens. They didn't know it was going to be a big deal. The idea of like a big event movie release, Star Wars created that. It didn't exist before. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the movie came out, they put it on, I don't know how many screens, Pablo or someone could tell you. And it became, and suddenly, like, the people at Fox are going, are you watching this? Are you seeing what's happening? Like, people can't get in the door. Like, this is, maybe we should put it on more screens. The next thing you know, it's a huge thing. And by the time Empire comes around, it is a huge thing. I believe they did have some toys, but, like, again, the idea of merchandising and toys and action figures based on the movie, Star Wars created all of that. Mm-hmm. None of that existed. And so there was so much demand for these toys that they just started issuing these cards. Like, we can't give you a toy, but here's like an exclusive piece of paper that says you're going to get a toy.
Yeah.
And even those now are considered like collectible items to have. Chris Weitz has one.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Yes. The article, I just briefly glossed over it on Twitter, but it said something like there was some of these are selling for like thousands of dollars.
There's a documentary about it on Netflix.
Is there?
Yeah. It goes through it all. Hey, yeah. They had the cardboard cut out and it said like, this guy's coming in this thing. And it was like, you could put the ones you had on it and then they had the spaces for what would be coming down the line. So you knew it was
that was good. I mean, that was always a fun thing to do with other people that watched on the movie, like whether it was me and Gareth or Chris or other people, you know, like what's your story that kind of makes you like the coolest fan? And Chris had that card.
Yeah.
And like Hal Hickel, who's the animation director of ILM. So like, if you liked K2SO, like Hal's a big part of why you liked him, because he animated and like all the eye movements, that's all him and his team at ILM. He has a framed piece of paper, a letter from Lucasfilm on his wall from 1977 that says, "Dear Hal," when he wrote this when he was like 7 or 8 years old.
Yeah.
"Thank you very much for your suggestions for a sequel to Star Wars. Unfortunately, you know, we develop all of those ideas ourselves and, you know, we don't really, but, you know, keep plugging away. And, you know, you're obviously very smart and one of these days you'll get there." And then years later, he has it framed on the wall because years later, George Lucas wrote on it going, "Yeah, you made it," when he was actually working at Lucasfilm. And so, you know, all of these people now, so many of the people that work at Lucasfilm are of the generation that grew up desperately loving this stuff, and now they actually get to put their hands in the clay play with it. Yeah.
Have you met Lucas?
No, Gareth did. I never met him.
This Gareth guy taking all your opportunities. Well, all the props.
I got to learn to direct. That's the key. You got to learn how to use a camera.
So that is a question of mine, right? Is that an ambition of yours eventually to kind of get more behind the camera?
I mean, maybe. I mean, no, I don't know. Not necessarily as, you know, as a specific thing that I want to do. And it's something I would have to learn. I have no idea how to frame a shot or, you know.
You just get a good DP for that.
Get a good DP. But as a way to stay on the train longer and, you know, kind of have more creative equity and, you know, in what you create, there's a number of ways to do that. But directing is certainly one of them, yeah.
That'd be crazy.
Yeah.
You helped write a Star Wars movie.
So yeah.
What the fuck? But
that's
hell.
The thing too. So I mean, I don't know if you can talk about kind of what's next for you, but obviously you're probably always working on ideas here and there. Do you know kind of what the next step is, or are you just like, you know what? I'm taking a you've been off this project for years, so you're clearly working on some other stuff.
Yeah, so I'm doing a movie right now for Fox called Mouse Guard, which is based on a very popular series of comic books, kind of like little furry Jedi Knights. They're mice with swords, and they protect the other creatures of the forest.
Oh, that's awesome.
Very popular comic. You ever read it?
Eisner,
you should do it, yeah.
Eisner Award series, winning series of comic books by David Peterson. They're fantastic books. And Matt Reeves, who makes the Planet of the Apes movies, is producing it, and we're going to try and make that this year.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I continue, and I'm working on, when I was done on Rogue, Lucasfilm very kindly asked me to stick around and work on Star Wars Rebels. So I did 3 episodes of Star Wars Rebels for this current season, 2 of which already came out. I got to write the Wedge Antilles origin story, which is really cool.
That's cool.
Disgruntled TIE fighter pilot that they bust out of an Imperial Flight Academy. So I got to write that episode. One, another one that was on a couple of weeks ago, and there's one more, I believe, this season, and then I did one for season four. So I got to do some stuff in the kind of animated TV Star Wars universe as well.
That's awesome. What's that process like? I imagine it's a lot more truncated than like, did you get a lot less time to work on that than the actual story for the movie?
Oh yeah, I mean, you know, you can't spend 3 or 4 years making a season of TV. You got to do one every year, and there's 22 episodes. And yeah, that's a fun process. Dave Filoni, who created the Clone Wars TV series with George, the animated TV series, is still at Lucasfilm and runs Star Wars Rebels, and is also, again, one of the kind of the major kind of brain trust people at Lucasfilm, and was one of the last guys to kind of really kind of learn. He was like kind of George's Padawan before George left, so like he understands, you know, what the kind of the George part of Star Wars is, and what he would like and what he wouldn't like, and you know, make sure that is still infused into everything that Lucasfilm creates. And you go to Skywalker Ranch and you sit in a big room with like 10 other writers and you come up with story ideas. It's a fun way to spend a day.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Is it much different than writing the movie? Because the movie, I imagine you're talking to people, but primarily you're just kind of by yourself, right? When you're developing.
Yeah, it's
ideas.
Much more, it's, well, I mean, not, again, on Rogue, I can't really go too much into the process, but, you know, I work very closely with Gareth and there are other people in the room that, you know, are kind of suggesting ideas. But for the most part on a film, yeah, it's generally just you on your own, and you might be working with the director or other
just
people.
I imagine you would just Mac on top at a Starbucks.
There's a lot, I mean, my job 90% of the time is sitting. Part of the reason why I'm active on Twitter and Facebook is like, that's how I interact. That's how I talk to people. I don't go out. I sit at home on my own most days.
Well, you're married.
In my gym jams.
I'm the same way.
It's a solitary, existence, profession. And I like that. I'm kind of a hermit most of the time, but every now and again, you know, it's fun to come do something like this. But TV is very, very different. TV, you sit in a room, you know, what they call breaking story, which is basically just means figuring out what the story is and what are the beats. What happens and why do we care and how does that lead into the next episode? And it's much more, most television is like this. It's much more collaborative. You sit in a room, in a writer's room with like a dozen people, and you all collaboratively break the story. And someone says, well, what if this happened? And someone says, oh, but yeah, what if you did that and added this twist? And it's a kind of a two brains are better, well, eight brains and 10 brains are better than one. And you all break the stories together. And then the episodes kind of get divvied out. Like, who wants to, like, I really wanted to write the Wedge episode, so they let me write the Wedge episode. But that story was created as a, like I said, as almost all TV shows are, like a group of people in a room figuring it out as a team.
But then had you been a big fan of Rebels before? I mean, how big of a learning curve is that for you to go in a room with people that have been writing on the show consistently since it came out?
I mean, it's a little bit, you know, a little bit in the deep end. It was weird because I had come from Rogue, and now I'm talking to the TV guys, and, you know, there's... they're connected, but not, you know, the people writing Rebels don't necessarily know everything that's happening on Rogue One and vice versa. And I had to learn, there's a learning curve because, you know, that there's a mythology to it and there's so much deep, you know, I like Star Wars, but I'm not necessarily the person that read every single, you know, expanded universe book and like watched, you know, every, you know, played every kind of like, you know, hardcore tabletop role playing game. Like the Pablo and those guys, they know all of that stuff and they have that like in their bones. Mm-hmm.
And did you have access to them during, like, especially for Rogue, right? Because I would imagine there's a huge amount of pressure on your shoulders when you're like, I'm doing an origin story. I have to get everything right. And not knowing some certain things might be a little bit.
Yeah, constantly. I mean, like that, I mean, it will get, if it's wrong, it will get caught at some point. But there are a lot of times where you just kind of like walk down the hall and say to someone, hey, what do you call these guys? Or could if this happened, would that contradict something else? And they just know the answer. And a lot of the times, again, as super Star Wars fans, you like the basic stuff, you know, but there might be something that is slightly more kind of, wow, that's like more of a real deep cut. And you just go ask someone. They have those people there. Oh, like, it's awesome. Their job to know this.
That's
stuff.
A great resource for you.
Yeah.
Very cool.
Just sitting in the room waiting for someone to ask a Star Wars question.
Well, no, but I mean, that's the thing too. Like you look at like kind of what Marvel does, right? And Marvel, one of the things that a lot of people talk about is like Kevin Feige over there has created this group of people that are resources and they go to like every movie that comes in, they just have this sort of set resource for everyone that's making it. So they can take these new directors or these new writers and kind of funnel them into this workflow that's already established. And I honestly think that's a really, really, that's a great reason why those films are succeeding. Right? And I have to imagine that's probably the same ecosystem that they're trying to create at Lucasfilm now, or at Disney rather, I guess, and Lucasfilm going into making more of these, right? It behooves you to say, Gary did a great job, or this person does a great job at this thing. let's keep them around so they can actually at least consult on this. I would imagine. I don't know.
Yeah, and you know, it's. I mean, Rogue's a good example. I mean, Rogue has elements of the prequels in it. It has elements of the Clone Wars animated show.
Watto, for sure.
Yeah, where was Watto? Who?
Can we ask Pablo? Let's get Pablo on the phone. Where's Watto at?
I'm just saying, there's always all these group scenes, people at bars. All I'm asking is in the back. Is that Watto's just chilling.
That's what you would want.
I'm a Watto fan.
What you would choose.
That's right.
No. Okay.
I'm just saying no to that.
Okay. That's just no.
I'm not saying he needs to be a main character. I just want to nod to him in the back.
Greg made his own kind of story, not origin story, but just like a continuation of Watto's life. So if you ever need any thoughts,
maybe I should figure out a way for you to like go and be able to go in and pitch that.
There you go. God. It'd be a great episode of some cartoon show because he becomes a horse. But not a horse. What? It's, you know, things the stormtroopers ride around on. Mm-hmm. One of them
Dewbacks.
Animals.
A Dewback.
Yeah. A Dewback. He becomes a Dewback. But he's still sentient. And he talks.
This is your right. This is your big idea.
maybe don't put him in a room to pitch that to anyone.
I was good to your mother.
But now he's a horse.
That's amazing.
It's his comeuppance.
See, that's a lot better than what I would have pitched. I would have pitched sort of a deep, dark, alcoholic like route with him.
No,
it's like
no,
after
no,
he
no,
lost
no,
his,
no.
his prize slave, he's just like, I gotta start hit the bottle.
Sure.
As hard as humanly possible.
This shows how bad things have gone though in the Empire.
Oh, he went bad, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like they cracked down on everything.
For sure.
Question for you. And this is one of those, I don't know how much, I don't want to get too much behind the scenes. Don't want to do anything you're not comfortable with.
Mm-hmm.
For Rogue One. It's a dark movie. Everyone keeps saying that, right? It's dark and it's serious, and that we love that, obviously. And it's, you know, it's Shades of Empire. It's this, that, and the other. When you were sitting down working on the story, was there a concern of going too far, being too dark, that kind of thing, or did you know because of what you were talking to with the Disney folks and Lucas folks that no, this is the kind of movie we want. We want it to be this war film and have this kind of moments in it.
I don't know if anyone ever sets out to, or if it's the right way to approach a film to say, well, you know, we're going to make the dark version of this. And I think you've seen enough of that. Like, I personally am, you know, the kind of the Zack Snyder version of Batman and Superman, that's not my personal taste. I don't care for that. Why is it always at night? Why is it always raining? Why is everyone unhappy all the time? Like, that's not what I look for in a comic book movie. And maybe some people like that, but it's not my taste. And you know, I don't think you set out to say, right, let's, I'm just talking purely in generalities. So like, I don't know if anyone ever sets out to say, well, let's make the dark Star Wars movie.
Gotcha.
Like, that's what people want. But you know, we knew that we were making a movie about the stealing the Death Star plans, and you find a tone that is appropriate for that story, whatever it may be. And you know, you say it's the darkest movie. I don't think it's necessarily any darker than Empire. I think Empire is still the darkest one. It has the downer ending. You know, it's really, really dark in places, mm-hmm. really scary in places. You know, I'd also make the argument that Rogue is one of the funnier Star Wars
films. Oh, yeah, 100%.
Like, yeah. Some of the biggest laughs I've ever heard in a theater watching a Star Wars movie are in Rogue. So, you know, it's, you know, you find
your own tone.
You can't have a movie, again, especially when a movie is darker, I think all the more reason to find the moments of, like, you know, kind of you need an exhaust port for the audience to be able to go like
levity,
you know, just gonna release, vent a little bit and have fun. You like how I used exhaust
port? I like that a lot. I like that a lot. I had to look over at Kevin for that.
Rogue One's awesome. Congratulations. How fucking awesome is that Darth Vader scene?
Which one? There's two.
The end one.
It's pretty great, right?
Oh, here we go.
There's it's so beautifully directed. I'll give you one piece of trivia about that scene.
Okay.
First of all, let me just say, like, again, speaking purely as a fan, that is probably in my top five Star Wars scenes of all time. That scene of Vader
definitely.
At the end. It's like the thing that you always wanted to see him do, just straight up murder everyone in the room, right? Because that's, you know, what is it like? You've seen Vader, right, fight Obi-Wan, Ahsoka. You know, these other, you know, characters that are basically kind of can take him on one-on-one. And you've seen him toy with people. Like, he's like, I could kill you anytime. You've seen that. But you've never seen the asymmetrical, like, what happens if you like, gave, like, 20 armed rebels and they went all out, like, what would happen? Well, the answer is, of course, he kills everybody.
Straight rage mode.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He just goes into beast mode. And it was this beautiful thing to see in the terror in that hallway.
Oh my God.
Right? That whole, like, relay of, like, take these, these through the door. You're like, oh my God, and it's just truly terrifying and amazing. And I'll tell you the piece of trivia. Because it's not difficult to spot. I don't know if people are looking for it, but the very last guy who throws the lever that releases the Tantive IV, that's Gareth.
Oh, really?
That's his cameo, yeah.
Oh, that's great. Yeah.
That's baller as hell.
That's a great place to hide in plain sight.
Yeah.
Because you're right, where it's just like, oh, God, I'm going to get it out, and it's Vader going to catch him. What's going to happen?
Blind after that scene, though. That scene was so intense. I was telling my wife that this morning. She was like, how was the movie? I was like, it was great. The last 5 minutes, here's what happens. And she's like, it was one of those things where I started telling her, and I started, like, tearing up. I was like, you don't understand. It just goes quiet for a second, and then you hear...
Boom, lightsaber comes on.
You
hear the mask first. It's dark, and you know it's there.
Yeah.
You just know what's there.
Yeah.
And then you see the light and the lightsaber, and you just know that every single person standing in that hallway is fucking dead. They are dead as disco.
And I love that he uses like every different possible way that he can just to kill them.
Oh my
God. Deflects the blasters, pulls the blasters out of their hand, chops them up with lightsabers, throws them into the wall, force chokes them, like every Sith talent.
It was
in the talent tree.
I love that final kill at the door.
Oh God!
When we get from the other side, the lightsaber comes through. It's like,
match on action on the other side. What I was telling my wife, and I was like, oh, you don't understand. Like, I haven't seen a scene like this in a movie since. Like the scenes that I think of are like when, like the first time you saw the Terminator, right? And you see that unstoppable character that is just
What he is in that scene, right? He's the Terminator.
He's the Terminator. You just know that everyone's dead, and there's that just feeling of like dread and doom for these characters that you just don't see that often in movies anymore.
Yeah.
The closest thing I could think of is like it's not the greatest movie ever, but RoboCop 2. Did you ever see that? Where
I did see it.
He's trapped. All the gang members are trapped in the warehouse with a big.
Kane,
and he's just going ape shit on all of them. You know they're all dead, and you're just terrified for these characters. The prior before that, you're like, I didn't even like these guys, but I just want them to get out of this fucking thing. Yeah, it was very much.
But the
like
beautiful
that.
Thing about it is that it's not just what I love about it, and this is the you talk about like how you balance tone. One of the things that I think is so like, and I say that's not my scene. I didn't do Vader in the hallway. That someone came up with that after me. And it's brilliant. I mean, it's brilliant idea.
Yeah.
But it's not just about Vader killing everyone. They don't forget, in spite of all that, they still win. They get the thing through the door and they get away. And it's a sense of like, even in like everyone, this is all going horribly wrong, but like just dead, like one last guy drops that thing. And this is what I like of it. So the best compliment I've heard of the movie, and I've heard it from several people now, is that they say that they think it makes the original film better.
It does. It really does.
Because for two reasons. One is I love the fact that you realize that the exhaust port is not there, the reason for it.
It's not there out of stupidity.
And it's a reason that's grounded in emotion and
I think that was honestly the best part of the entire movie. Like like Vader seemed great, fantastic. But the fact that when that happened, when we see the hologram and he's like,
twice now I've seen it, when Mads is giving that speech and he's saying, I've planted a trap, a flaw. And you see people realizing, oh, that's what's going on.
I turned to Kevin, who had already seen it, and I was like, it's the most obvious, simplest, most fucking genius thing. That was perfect. That one little line, I'm like, oh, yes, that makes all the difference now in this grand thing. Because, what's the one criticism of A New Hope? It's like, why would this great grand empire?
I personally got sick of people on the internet, these memes that go around, well, if the empire's so smart, how'd they miss that? I was like, I'll tell you.
Yeah.
I will literally tell you.
It's so good. That was such a great aha moment where I was like, oh, yeah.
So that is beautiful.
That's what this whole movie should be
and
about.
I love that it comes from a place of like, it's like an act of defiance, right? It's there for a reason that you understand. And the other thing I love about it, and this is more of a general thing, I haven't done this yet, but I think that when next time you watch A New Hope, now that you know what it took to get those plans that far,
you really appreciate it.
Don't you feel like you'd be more invested now in everything that happens to them?
Yeah, definitely.
It's like all those people, everything they went to and they nearly didn't get it so many times and they all fucking died. We killed everyone on the poster except Vader. Everyone.
Oh, it's crazy.
Right?
Yeah.
And you loved those characters. Yeah, yeah.
Oh my God, the other moment where he's like, Vader will take care of them, and all the ships try to go out to hyperspeed, and then the Star Destroyer just plows into
it. Right, that, like, one, that one transport does not get away.
No, it does not.
Yeah.
It goes straight into it. Just those moments where you're like, it really did. It was a great, great, great sense of, like, impending doom. That urgency at the end there, that race to the end, was really well done.
Yeah, that little passing of the baton down the hallway. This, for me, that, and again, I'm just, forget that I worked on it. Just talking, I'm a fan with you guys. That last 5 minutes, you go from Jin and Cassian on the beach and that beautiful moment, you know, with the kind of the wall of fire, firestorm is coming in. And that's like, oh, you're just killing you. And then Vader in the hallway, which is a whole other kind of like, I can't believe what I'm watching. And then the last minute where you realize, oh, we're in A New Hope now. And you see Leia, that final shot where she turns around, the gasp in the audience is just like,
yeah, our auditorium went crazy.
Blown away by it. Because I think what they did with Tarkin was incredible. But Leia in particular, I was like, that's perfect.
Yeah, that was really cool. That's a cool moment. So,
it's another way to do it.
It's the same thing though, where there wasn't a gasp in ours. There was nonstop cheering. Yeah. And I'm like, I think she said it's Hope. I'm pretty sure. So she said Hope.
That's the other thing. It's like when I remember, because again, I knew what was coming, and I know it all ends very quickly. And you know, when Tilly's opens the door and you see her from behind in the rope, people just erupt. And I remember thinking, I hope this dies down quickly because the line is coming, like right behind this. And then she turns, and at that point, I guess different audiences are different. In my
auditorium,
twice I've seen it, when you see her from behind, people cheer. When she turns around, people gasp. And like the line, Antilles says, "What is it that they've sent us?" And she says, "Hope." And that, but a lot of people don't hear the line because they're too busy losing their shit.
Yeah, it was just the right balance.
I love it because so I got to see it a couple days ago with Kevin, and then last night, like, all my friends got to go see it, like normal people.
Wait, so how did you get to see it ahead of time? Like a press thing?
Same thing.
Kevin's Paula.
Oh, right.
Paula,
okay.
Animated some X-Wings in the movie. No big deal. Pretty fucking cool. So we got to go see it, which was super awesome. But yeah, when the Leia thing happened, it was like honestly, like I didn't cry, but it felt like crying. Like my face, like it was like such an emotional drain where I looked at Kevin.
Something in your eye?
And it was more than that. It was my body where I was like, oh my fucking God, they're doing this. But what I love is my friends got to see it, and three separate people texted me things to the point of, my God, the last 20 minutes, that Vader scene, God damn, this was perfect. The last 20 minutes were perfect. That's awesome.
And that's the thing too, is I was like, as we're sort of racing toward that end, I'm like, I want this to end the way I think it's going to end, but it could be real easy for that not to go the right way. You know? And I'm like, eh.
It's interesting. I love the way that they did it in the end is, you know, K2 dies first. Yeah. And you kind of go, well, that's sad. We liked him, but like, someone's not coming back, right? You know, the very best case scenario, someone's not coming back. You got to kill someone off. Maybe it's the droid. That's the least. Even though we like him, like, it's maybe some weird bias that allows me to say maybe the droid is the most expendable one. I don't know, but he died.
Well, because he's the easiest one to bring back.
He's the heroic sacrifice, right? And then Bodhi goes, and you go, oh. He's dead as well. And then Chirrut and Baze, and you wait, are they going to kill everybody?
Yeah.
And
that was the thing when, and I'm, you know, I like Star Wars fine. I'm not like the super nerd fan like Tim, right? So like, I've been like, oh, I can't wait to see Rogue One, but haven't been following up on it. So I don't know anybody's names. So like, but with the gunner, when he started saying the force line over and over again, I was like, oh, he's going to continue on the legacy. And then he gets killed. I'm like, oh, no, there's no hope here.
And there's something, you know, maybe this is, you'd have to ask Gareth about the way that he put this together. But, you know, maybe there's something, you know, usually characters, when you die in a movie like Star Wars, like when Han Solo dies in Force Awakens, that's a big deal, right? Like, they make a big, big moment out of it. When Bodhi dies, it just happens.
Yeah.
And you just move on to the next thing. And you're like, you realize, oh, yeah, these lives are expendable. And people just die. And this isn't always romantic or beautiful. Or you don't always get your big moment. You just die. And hope that you're not the last one. That there's someone else still going. And there's something about that that's like, it's not something that a Star Wars film has ever done before. And again, just speaking purely as a fan, It's like it's really it's shocking, but in a great way.
I thought it was portrayed really nicely in this movie too, in a way that I don't think I've ever seen in any movie where the characters had their moments. They had their I'm gonna give a speech. I'm gonna do something epic. I'm gonna complete the thing I need to complete. Like all that happened, but in the actual moment of their death, whether it was Forrest Whitaker, the Saw Gerrera, mm-hmm. or whatever the name is, and all the characters going down, the actual moment they die wasn't some like. Forrest Whitaker was standing there and he didn't like close his eyes as he did it. He was just looking at it and like then the thing overcomes
him. They all get a moment, but they don't, apart from with Jen and Cassian at the very end, like the movie doesn't like linger on it and like try and make a big deal of it. Like are you feeling something?
Well, it cuts away right before it happens.
Right,
like
right
when
as the wave comes
when
in.
When the pilot Bodie was in the thing, like it cuts away before it overtakes him. Like it starts exploding and
it's beautiful. And again, it's amazing the way, like, again, this is where you realize how smart direction and smart editing like helps tell a story. It's like there's a moment where the grenade comes into the shuttle and you see Bodie and you go, oh shit, he's going to die. But then they cut away. And it's just something that now happens in the background.
Yeah.
Right? But there's a band and you go, oh, like, this is just, it was just an incidental thing mm-hmm. that happened. But you love that character. But like we don't have time to worry. We got to keep going. Like the plans are still not away yet.
Well, yeah,
and that's why you're constantly just like white knuckle all the way through that last act.
I like how you guys set it up too. With that, she has that one line where she's like, "We're going to keep going," and like when we lose,
take the next chance.
Chance and the next chance until we don't have any more chances. You know, and that's you're like, okay, I see where this is going, and you did, and you delivered on that. Where it felt like. It was just enough so the football got passed to the next person mm-hmm. who was running at that last 10 yards. Then it got passed to the next person. It was that relay race. And it really worked. It set that tension.
Yeah, and going back to the thing of it making A New Hope even better, like I think that the dynamic of Krennic and Tarkin is just, it adds so much depth to characters that already had so much depth. Like the relationship between Krennic, Tarkin, Vader, Emperor. Looking through all of that, there's always this sense of like trying to impress the person that's not above you, but that's above them, you know?
Yeah. And I'll go over his head and impress the guy above him.
Yeah. And then the person right above you trying to fucking take it from you, you know? And it reminded me a lot of the Emperor, Luke, and Vader at the end of Jedi when he was just like, join me and we can overcome this. And it's just like, it's such a cool thing because the scene of Krennic looking up and seeing the Death Star about to blow his ass up is like so rewarding when we now know that Tarkin's the one that's said to do that. And Tarkin's a fucking asshole.
Yeah, it's
really interesting look at kind of the difference between the Alliance and the Empire. They're both kind of broken systems, right? And you see it in the movie. Like the Rebellion's kind of broken partly because it is... so democratic, right? And you see everyone around the table. I say we fight. I say we scatter the fleet. And Mon Mothma is in charge, but she can't just say, "Well, I'm the Emperor, and I say we go." And things. I need the support. I need democratic support. And like everyone has to agree, and that it kind of paralyzes them that they have this democratic system. The Empire, of course, the Emperor makes a decision and it gets done, and that's why probably the reason why the Empire is so much more efficient. But at the same time, like you said, it's really interesting. You haven't seen it to this extent before, that kind of venality and the idea that Krennic and Tarkin are both like kind of jostling for like who's really going to get the credit for this and mm-hmm. who's really going to come out on top. And it's like Krennic tries to throw Tarkin under the bus when he's wanting to be, well, that was Tarkin did that. You should talk to him. Constantly looking for a way to kind of like get ahead. And mm-hmm. I love how ambitious Krennic is. You'll talk to the Emperor about me. You'll tell him.
Yeah.
He's so pleased with him. He's like, oh, I'm going up in the world. I love that. Ben is so great in that movie.
It was great and good motivations too for that character. That was one of the things where you're like, I get it. I see myself in this guy. Like I understand what ambition is and how run amok it can turn you into this monster that this guy is. And then going back to your earlier point, like you don't really get a sense of who the Alliance is in A New Hope, right? You do now. You understand that it is a varying group of people that are coming together to make this sort of democratic group that has to fight the Empire, and there's a reason why they're a little disorganized when the New Hope starts, right? Like it fleshed out more of that story and really does make you appreciate how the fourth movie starts.
Yeah, and I have my theory about that is that it's really the Death Star that is the Empire's undoing. That there's a sense that the rebels are so disorganized and they can't agree on anything. Are we fighting these guys or what? Are we just kind of like pecking away at them? Like, is this war or not? Like, what are we doing? And there's a sense of like, again, going back to the crawl, the crawl says the rebels have won their first victory against the Alliance, against the Empire, which, you know, suggests that there hasn't really been like a state of like open war between them. It's mm-hmm. Scarif and Battle of Yavin that really creates like full-on open war between the Empire and the Rebel Alliance. And the Rebels aren't really an alliance. I say we fight. I say we scatter. Like, they're not allied. They're all over the place. And I have this personal theory, again, just as a fan, that if the Empire had never built the Death Star, they probably would have won just through attrition. Just mm-hmm. let the rebellion fall apart on its own. Like, they can't agree on anything. Whereas we not only have superior technology and superior resources, but we have one guy at the top telling right. us what to do. And even though that, you know, dictatorship is not great for the galaxy, the Empire is way more, they've got their shit together way more than the rebellion, even with all the kind of jockeying for ambition and power. But when they build the Death Star, they do something so egregious that it forces the rebellion to say, all right, then it is war.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right. Then we have no choice but to do something that they never would have done what they did if, you know, the Empire had built that thing.
Another huge compliment I can give this movie is that I think that it gave so much lore building to give people the ability to have theories. Beyond what we're just expecting, because like with things, there's so many theories about who's Snoke and all this stuff for episode 8 and 9. But I think that with this, it's cool because it's giving us the ability to now have theories about something that we thought we already knew so well. Mm. And it opens up all these different doors. And I loved seeing the shades of gray on both sides. Whereas, you know, back in the day, it was the light side and the dark side. But then even with Force Awakens, with this new, the kind of now we're going to begin to make things right. It's like it is trying to show that, hey, not all bad guys are horrible and not all good guys are great. And I loved seeing that not only in this movie did the Diego Luna. Mm-hmm. Well, what was his character's name?
Cassian,
yeah.
He does some bad things. He kills someone right away, right?
Right off the bat, he kills somebody.
Because he has like, to.
That's, yeah.
Because if that guy doesn't die, the Empire's going to get him and he's mm-hmm. going to talk.
Yeah, and it's like that shows like that's where the good guys are at. And then the bad guys, like the scene of Mads Mikkelsen putting Jin to bed when they're there and he's like in the Empire outfit, it's just like, man, like that's so humanizing. And like he's a good guy. And, there's good guys there.
And Bodhi makes a choice, right? Clearly Bodhi, he made a choice.
The entire
I'm not doing
team
this
of engineers
anymore.
Look like they don't want to be
they
there.
They don't really want to be
you
there.
You know, and it's like that really, it makes you go from seeing every person we've seen in the Empire before episode 7 was like, you are a Nazi. You are a bad guy.
Yeah.
But then when you look at it from the other point of view now, it's just like, no, there's a bunch of good guys there.
And it's what I love about Guerrera as well, that there is this idea of there's this kind of militant extremist faction of the rebellion. It's
so that
cool.
He's splintered off, right? Because he's too extreme.
Yeah. And that was there from the beginning. This idea is like, well, what does it look like? You know, again, this idea of like, and I'd love to see this played out, whether it's a book or some other way that they tell this story. But there's a I think, in my own headcanon, a day in the past where Guerrera's around that table with Mon Mothma and Dodonna and Bail Organa and saying, well, I think this and I think that. And he's saying, like, we need to be hitting them harder and doing this and that. Like, well, that's not the way we do it. And Saw says, well, I'm doing it. And he just leaves and he creates this kind of splinter faction that is now so militant and so extreme that it's actually become like a PR problem for the rebellion.
Right.
Right. That, like, you hear Mon Mothma say it, like, he's caused us a lot of problems. Right. Because he hits the Empire and they come after us. Because they can't find him. Mm-hmm. And we don't agree with his tactics.
We don't agree with him so much that we're going to give an order to kill him. The good guys give an order to kill him.
The Orbot, they kill. Yes. They want to kill Mads.
They want to kill
Galen.
Yeah. That was a little ambiguous. Yeah, when he says, she says the line, the captain or general's line, if you find him, kill him. He meant
Galen.
They need Saw to get to Galen.
There's the great scene with Forrest Whitaker when he is talking to Jin. There's that moment where he's like,
are you here to kill me?
Yeah, he's so paranoid. Because he's like the most wanted man in the galaxy, right? Everybody wants to kill him. Like the rebellion probably, I have a theory that the rebellion could kill him. They probably would because he's more trouble than he's worth. Mm-hmm. And the Empire definitely want to kill him.
It was cool though. It's cool that, I mean, traditionally we haven't seen this, but this is on the level of like politics of like a House of Cards or a Game of Thrones. Like you guys really went and took that extra step to make those dimensions happen, which I think honestly really is the strength and a good foundation for why this film succeeded. Like it wasn't just like Tim was talking about good and bad. There were those shades of gray, and in those shades of gray are these really interesting, human stories that you
guys and it's only at the, you know, it's one of the great things about that story is you get, you only get to address that like at that moment in time. Like again, by the time you are watching A New Hope and Empire, the Rebel Alliance is fully kind of galvanized and together, and again, the Death Star is the thing that kind of makes them realize like, yeah, the Empire is truly evil. And we have, there's no pretending anymore. We have to fight these guys. It's very interesting. There's a great line in the movie where Mon Mothma says, if you find Galen Erso, bring him back so we can testify to the Senate. Like, they're still looking for like a political way to solve these problems. Like, they want to solve these problems peacefully. And, you know, Guerrero, I think, is like, you're never going to resolve anything. Yeah. The Empire has no interest in resolving anything politically. Like, it's going to be a zero-sum game one way or the other. And in the end, he's right. I find that fascinating that in those final moments before the Rebel Alliance truly kind of comes together through, you know, the example that Jin sets for them, it's scrappy and it's ugly and they can't agree. And again, my personal theory is if the Empire never build the Death Star and they can't stop it, then yeah, they just start wiping up planets and it's over anyway. But if they don't ever build the Death Star, I think rebellion just kind of falls apart on its own.
Yeah.
And you see that, right? They can't agree on anything.
So you wrote a Star Wars.
Co-wrote
a Star Wars. You had a hand in making a Star Wars. So I'm trying to pass all the credit around to everybody else, Witta. Do you now, do you feel like you could do anything? You could write anything? Like from here on out, like, literally the world has to be your oyster right now. There's not a franchise or an IP too big for you, right?
I don't know. It's, you know, part of the weirdness about it is like, what is there next to do?
Like, that's what I was thinking right now. What would be like, I have to imagine this would have been pretty high on the list of dream projects.
Well, I mean, I'm really excited about Mouse Guard and I'm working some other things that I can't talk about. And I've got lots of original ideas I want to do. And like, if this movie, the fact that it's well received and it's successful and I'm associated with it means that I have opportunities to do things that I might not have had before, that's great.
Yeah.
But I don't feel like I can do anything. I'm invincible now because I helped on this thing. We'll see what happens.
Okay. Because I feel like when you know Disney announced they bought Star Wars and they were going to put one out every, they're going to do side stories and stuff like that. Like, that had to have been a moment where for so many people the eyes light up of like, oh my god, maybe there's a possibility one day of me being able to do this. And then you got to go do it right away.
I'll tell you a story. I'll tell you a story about that. I remember I was specifically, I may have told you this story before because it predates Rogue. I remember when I found out that this is like weirdly like the Kennedy moment of our generation. It's like everyone remembers where they were when they found out that Disney had bought Lucasfilm.
It's literally a Kennedy moment.
It's true.
Yeah, it's a good
version of a Kennedy moment.
Yeah, I walked upstairs at IGN. Like I excused myself.
See, you remember,
from the work.
Right?
Oh,
you were there.
Totally.
You had to excuse yourself.
I called.
Did you have to let go, take a moment?
Well, no, straight up, I did. I did, and I called Kevin, and I was just like, Kevin, they're making episode 7, 8, 9, and he was just like,
"This is happening."
He was like, "What? What are you talking about?" I'm like, "No." George Lucas sold it to Disney. This is fucking real. They announced a trilogy, and it was just like a weird moment. But yeah, I'll never forget that.
I was standing in line at a Popeye's Fried Chicken.
Yeah, you were.
Did I tell you this story?
I don't.
Oh, you just assumed. I'm just saying.
That sounds
right.
Fuck yeah, you're eating Popeye's Fried Chicken. Yeah.
My personal theory on Popeye's, by the way, they don't have the best chicken.
Yeah.
If the chain chicken, I think KFC has the best.
Okay.
But biscuits. They have the best mashed potatoes and biscuits.
Oh,
I guess this would never happen. If there was like a KFC and a Popeyes next to one another, or if I was like some kind of douchebag who had assistants that I could make run all over town, I would get the chicken from KFC, but I'd have the mashed potatoes and biscuits from Popeyes. Mm-hmm. Right? Do you get that?
Oh no, it's like going to Burger King, get the burger, but go to McDonald's, get the fries.
No, that doesn't work.
I'm just saying.
You can leave, Greg.
I said like that. I didn't say I would do that.
Burger King clearly the winner in that.
The winner?
Yeah, I don't 100%. Like anything on the Burger King menu
what?
At all.
Yeah. The Whopper and the fries
I'll eat there if I'm desperate. I'll eat there if I'm desperate, but it's not. Have you seen the latest iteration of their French fries? Every time they reinvent their French fries, they just make them worse. Like, what's the next version going to be? Just like actual trash? I don't like...
Talk shit, get shot. I don't know. The last time I remember having Burger King fries, I remember thinking, you know, these are far superior to McDonald's. I actually
had fries.
The fries. They were thicker. They were crunchier, crispier, and they just had more consistency.
I would say.
And the Whopper is flame broiled. You can't take that away.
My personal favorite fries from the chains are Wendy's fries. But If you can get the first batch out of the fryer at McDonald's, like hot and fresh and salty, those are manna from heaven.
The fries are great. I don't think it's beyond. I don't think it's crazy to say Burger King might have the better cheeseburger.
You're nuts.
That is crazy.
Are you kidding me?
That is crazy.
The number two at McDonald's, the two cheeseburger meal.
Colin.
Classic.
Colin backs me on this. Hey, come in here real quick. Then you can get back to editing. Sorry, we love you.
People be like, Colin was there and he's not on the podcast?
He's got to edit. Colin was right. The new hit show. Do. Colin, come to my microphone and answer me a question right now.
Take
your
pants off. Just take them off.
Have you been hearing any of this? Because I don't want this to get tilted.
I've had my headphones off.
There is a Burger King and a McDonald's next to each other. Where do you go for your cheeseburger?
And where do you go for your fries?
You go to McDonald's for the fries, for sure. But you go to Burger King for the burger. I also want to say, Gary, this is I'm really sad that I'm missing this episode.
Colin, I'm sad too. I wanted you to be a part of it.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm editing a video. We're against it right now. So, hello everyone. I'm sorry. I love you all.
Should we do that? Let's do a hug.
Yeah, hug each other.
So proud of you, Gary. You smell good.
Thank you.
What is he that? Always smells good. Soap. Man. He just
is that just soap?
Soap and deodorant. That's it.
You do smell good.
I gotta find out what your products are because that's a good smell.
Dove for men.
It's Dove for men.
Dove for men.
You got a loofah going, or are you just rubbing on your body?
Yeah. I rub myself in different ways, but I have the loofah. Sure.
So you're out of Popeyes.
I don't know. I feel like we're on a track here that needs to get resolved. I gotta just go back.
I don't think we're ever gonna agree.
Some riffs are too big.
You'll have to come back for a fourth appearance.
I remember back in the day that dumb as shit wings, boneless or bone-in wings that you got into, and it became this internet thing.
Right.
Just can't you just eat that you eat what you like and let people eat what they like?
The internet.
Yeah. No,
you can't
not.
Have an opinion that differs from me because you're stupid if you do, and that's the internet in a nutshell.
I guess that is the internet. But yeah, so I found out last night that I'm a boneless man. I was actually, for some reason, like it came up that I was at a Wingstop. You ever been to a Wingstop?
I've been to a Wingstop.
Of course you have.
Come on now.
You missed the wings.
Yeah.
I was at a Wingstop in Hayward. You know, I mean, why not? And they give you the choice. They give you the choice. Do you want bone in or bone out?
Yeah.
And I went with boneless. In that moment, I discovered a little bit about who I am. I went boneless.
You want a fun Wingstop story?
Sure, why not?
I'm doing a summer internship out in Washington, D.C. I'm in college. It's between junior and senior year. I meet the people I'm working with for the first time. They're other interns. They're cool kids. I go to their house. We're getting ready to go out to the bars that night. I'm down there. We're doing the normal, you know, how are you? Who are you away from?
Right,
kind of thing.
Right.
Meet. And out of the corner of my eye, I see chicken wings on the TV. And I look over, and it's a commercial for Wingstop. First time I'd ever heard of a Wingstop. Mm-hmm. And this girl, Ricky's talking, and I go, can you be quiet for a second? And I look over, and it was Troy Aikman telling me how good Wingstop was, and I should eat there and all this stuff. And it ended, and I'm like, all right, sorry. I'd never heard of this chicken wing restaurant. I'm going to go to it tomorrow.
So you cut off a girl that you were with so you could, you could watch a chicken wing commercial.
Exactly. And she said, you're an advertiser's dream. Because that was
the
thing.
You really are.
There was a new chicken wing restaurant. I had also researched which chicken wing restaurant I would eat at when I was going out there. It was called, I think it was Wings and Beer. They had a 25-cent Tuesday deal going on that I would go to all the time. All alone.
You and I still have a date that we've never made to actually go to a Buffalo Wild Wings together and hang out. We need to do that.
If only you weren't so busy.
Let's do it in the new year.
Okay, sounds good. Can they all come?
Who?
These guys.
Yeah, of course.
Okay, cool.
More the merrier.
All right, good. Yeah, because we've been bringing it back a lot, bringing the Wild Wings back here a lot.
Oh, but are they good? So I've never had the wings there.
Oh, yeah.
I've never actually been there. Oh, you know they're opening a Dave and Buster's in the neighborhood?
Yes, I did. Yeah.
Let's go to that. Let's do that, too.
Okay, cool. All right.
Have you seen it from the outside?
No.
It looks like a lot of fun.
Just with the hoarding.
Wait,
I haven't seen it finished yet.
Where is this happening?
It's at Serramonte.
Really?
Yeah. Serramonte.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I think when it opens, we should make a point. We should all go.
Okay, that sounds like a deal. We'll put you in the Star Wars Battle Pod.
Oh, yeah.
You been in there?
Yeah,
it's going to be open before the holidays. I mean, it's like there's only like 2 weeks left.
It looks pretty done, though. From the inside, it doesn't look done because it's all boarded up. But from the outside, it's like they literally have a giant glass thing that just says fun.
How can you argue that?
That's how you know you're having fun.
So Buffalo Wild Wings, good. They're fine. They're chain wings. They're good. Yeah,
right.
But I would always tell you to go to Wing Wings down in Lower Haight, of course.
Wing Wings?
Wing Wings. Support the local businesses, the local guys. What up, Christian? You're in line at a Popeyes.
I was in line at a Popeyes, and I'm looking at my phone, and I see my phone starts blowing up with the hot takes.
Yeah,
something's funny. Has you know these days you see the hot take before you see what the story.
Oh yeah,
why is this person freaked out? And you got to go bang go. Oh, because this happened, and it was Disney. You know, $4 billion. George had sold it, and there wasn't. You ever remember at the time there was nothing else attached to that. There was no JJ. Michael Arndt was actually the first thing announced. But it was obvious. I think he said that. And yes, the first project out of the gate will be episode seven. But there was no, this was long before there was any talk of like standalone films or anything. Like nobody knew what it meant. But I instantly, you know, these phones are magic and can do anything. I went straight from my Twitter application to my phone. I'm in line with my peeps.
You pop by peeps?
They're not even people I know, but they're at Popeyes, so they're my peeps.
And I got my age.
I said, I'm sure everyone's calling you, and I'm sure everyone's calling. Every writer in town is calling their agent right now. But like, you gotta get my hat in the ring. I mean, I know I'm not gonna get it because I'm a middle range writer. Like, I'm not nobody. I've had some movies made. Like, people know who I am, but I'm not, Tony Gilroy or Chris White. So I want to let the A-list guys. And so I thought, but the 10-year-old kid that still lives inside of me is never going to shut up if I don't at least make.
You got to try.
So I did it, all right?
I think that's the moral.
What do you want from me?
You made shut up. That's the moral of that story, though, is I think that it's important for people because you said, like, oh, I'm sure a bunch of people calling. I'm not so sure that a bunch of people called. You fucking did it, and you got it.
That's not why I got the job. I made the call, and then, and nothing happened for a long time. And it wasn't because at the time they sold it, they knew yet what they were going to do, like what the plan was. The idea for like developing the standalone films came as they like, okay, well, we have this thing now. What do we do? Well, what about standalone films? But at the time that I was making that call, they didn't even know that was a thing yet. And it wasn't until they decided that I got a call months later, completely separately, to come in and meet with them.
Now, they obviously had the idea already there. Like, what did you have to bring in with you?
I can't talk about any of that.
Okay, can't talk about any of that. No problem.
No, it's a bit he had to bring in the firstborn and be like, please.
He's a yours. I don't know why you're Italian all of a sudden.
Mamma mia.
Oh, man.
God, that's crazy though. But that's gotta be a pretty emotional thing though. When you get the call saying, yo, you got this, you're like, oh, like what is that?
I mean, there was a lot of passing the thing down the hallway. Because it was like various different moments of okay, I've met with this person and now I've got to meet with it's like any like on any job, but you know, the bigger the job, the more ranks you have to go through. Like the head of the studio has to meet you. Like usually the head of the studio would not have to sign off on me to work on a movie, but with something of that scale, they want to meet you. So I had to like go and meet like Alan Horn and like the top people at Disney before I was officially kind of allowed to like start working.
What do you wear when you go to that meeting? Thank God.
Will tell you that
it's July. Why are you in a Christmas sweater?
It's funny. It's funny that you ask. I remember I actually was wearing the meeting with Alan Horn and Kathy Kennedy, which was like the final thing where they had to decide if, you know, I was going to be a part of this. I was wearing what I didn't know at the time, but which I now know to be my lucky R2-D2 pants, underpants.
Good. Good.
And I was sitting
Are you wearing those right now?
I was sitting in, no, but I was sitting in the airport with John Nahl afterwards because John was in the meeting as well. And we were both flying back from Burbank. And I said, I know this. I feel like it went well, John, because I'm wearing my lucky pants. And he was like, all right, you know, that's pretty much all I need to know. But look. And I went, he's like, I don't need to see. I trust that you're wearing R2-D2 pants. I don't need to see them. I showed him my underpants on the red carpet as well. Did you see that?
No.
Oh, it was my favorite moment.
Really are.
This is the best part of the premiere, right? So what they did was, it was so cool. They invited a lot of the fans, like the hardcore fans, like 501st Legion and Rebel Legion, and like the guys that dress up, and R2-D2 Builders Club, and the guys that build the droids, and Mandalorian mercs, and the people that dress up like kind of Boba Fett, and like the real hardcore super fans. And there was a press line where all the Entertainment Tonight and all those people are, but there was a whole separate area where they had put all the rebels on one side and all the Empire on the other, the different cosplayers. So if you're like a Vader or a Stormtrooper or whatever, you're on that side. And if you're a rebel, you're on the other side. So they created this kind of like mock adversarial where they were like kind of flipping each other off across the red carpet.
That's
like
awesome.
Mon Mothma and like the Emperor, like, yeah, this is hilarious. And I went straight over to the rebel side because those are my people.
You just dropped your pants.
No,
just
I didn't.
Like your Popeye R2's here.
I didn't drop. Here's what happened. So before I realized what it was, I thought it was all on one side. And I went over to the rebel. I went over to the Imperial side, and I signed someone's Stormtrooper helmet. It's so weird. Like, there's a person with you, for like, if you're famous, you don't need this person. But if you're not, you do need the person. The PR people give you a handler who walks you around and makes sure that you talk to the people you're supposed to and you don't talk to the people you're not. Literally, she's standing there next to me with a thing that says, Gary Witter story. Like, so the people know who I am.
Sure, sure.
And people saw me and they, you know, the Star Wars fans actually do give a shit about. Entertainment Tonight did not give a shit about me. And rightly so, because I'm not famous or attractive. But the fans do, because they like the people that create the stuff. And again, before I realized that this was like an adversarial thing, I just wandered over to the Imperial side. And I'm signing the helmet, and I'm hearing this boo. I'm not going over. I'm getting booed by the Rebels. I can't have that. I'm not going to get booed by Rebels. If you have to pick sides, I'm rather be a Rebel.
Smash the helmet. Yeah.
But I went, I said, I got to go talk to them. Oh, you don't want to die. I got to go talk to the Rebels. And I went over there. And they said, you're not really a Rebel. It's all like good fun. Like, you're not a Rebel. And I said, I am a Rebel. And I was had a Rebel Alliance t-shirt that I showed them.
Very nice.
And I still have my crew. This is my wristband from the set that I've had. I haven't taken this off in 2.5 years.
What? Really?
Awesome. Yeah, this is the crew wristband.
Wow.
It says, Go Rogue and Orabesh.
You want to go Skycam? You bring it in there. Like, I can read Kev's mind. I guess,
how do you do that?
Just show it to us and then we'll move it. There you go.
There you go. It used to say fight the Empire underneath, but that kind of washed off over the years. Don't do that.
It's too late. That's the new touch in the knee. We're escalating.
Yeah. Gareth does this on every movie. He had a green, it's a good luck charm for him. He did it on Godzilla. He had a green one that said Janjira, which was the company from the Godzilla movie, the corporation. And then he did it on this, and everyone on the crew had one.
So what's your plan for taking it off?
I don't know yet.
Yeah. You can't just take it off.
I had it on for so long, and it's so, like, just a rubber band. Like, you don't even know that you've got it on. Like, I just feel like maybe I'll just never take it off. Huh. But where was I going? Oh, so I was on the red carpet, and I was getting grief from, like, this Jyn Erso, like, this cosplayer, and Mon Mothma, and these Rebel guys are, like, giving me grief. And I'm having this from these people. You're my guys. I'm a Rebel. Like, no, you're not a Rebel. I said, look, I got a Rebel t-shirt, big crest here, and I showed them this thing, and they still weren't convinced. And I had a Rebel Alliance underpants. And I said, if this is what I got to do, I'll do it. And I was like, kind of put this whole thing on the on the red carpet. And
Mads is walking by, just shaking his head.
I was like super, like, the person that says Gary Witter story is like inching away from me.
She just drops the board.
Yeah.
Lights it on fire.
But that was my favorite part of the whole thing, aside from actually seeing the movie, was hanging out with before and after the super fan. And it was the loveliest thing. You go to these premieres and they give a lot of tickets to, you know, like, just celebrities, just like famous people,
sure,
that, you know, make for good pictures on the red carpet and help create, you know, a spectacle. And of course, obviously all the filmmakers there are there and the studio people and all the people that, like, you know, have a stake in the movie. But a lot of celebrities just to create buzz. I got some, Nathan Fillion gave me chewing gum, which I still have because I refused to throw it away even after it was chewed.
you really are one of us, Gary.
I still have it. So all those people.
Yeah.
But I thought it was one of the nicest things that they did is they gave an allotment of tickets, quite a few tickets, to just fans to come in and see it.
Yeah.
And, you know, those are the people who are, like, more than anyone else want to see the film.
Of course.
And I thought that was great that they came in. And that was my most fun part of it, was not meeting the celebrities or the cast or you know, even like Kevin Smith, people like that who I really like and, you know, were pleased to meet, but like the fans who you can just see the joy on their faces. They're just so happy to be there and they're so happy that Star Wars is back. And I was like, oh, I got caught up in all of it with them. It's beautiful.
So the question for you, I guess, would be, how difficult is it to carry the secret for as long as you did, right? Because it is that thing of, like, even once you get announced, we didn't know what it was. And having personal conversations with you, right, you'd talk about all sorts of stuff, but you never ever tipped your hand to what it was or what your story would be. Like, and I assume, obviously, because there's so many players in it, Disney's involved, you've signed contracts, you're a good dude. But I have to imagine at some point, you're doing all this amazing, awesome fucking shit and you can't tell people about it. And is that, like, infuriating? Is it cool? Is it whatever? Because, like, we're getting ready for, you know, January 5th, 2017, right? It's the next Kind of Funny day. We're going to announce a whole bunch of new stuff. And it's like, I don't want to tell everybody about that, but it's not fucking, I'm just doing Star Wars and I'm going to tell you why the Death Star is the Death Star.
Yeah, it's difficult because, you know, as a fan, you want to talk about this stuff. And I'm a fan first. And, you know, there was a 6-month period where I wasn't even allowed to tell anyone I was working on, between the period of like actually having a signed contract to work on the movie and being able to tell anyone that I was, because they had not announced the project. And if I say I'm doing something, that means there's a project.
Sure.
I couldn't even
tell
anyone. And I had to wait for 6 months. I couldn't even say anything. And when it was announced, that was kind of a relief. But then you can't tell anyone what it is. And then, you know, they announced, well, it's called Rogue One and it's about the Death Star plans and little bits and pieces. But like, you know, for the longest time, I remember going, oh, you know, like oh, sorry, that's really annoying. Oh, that's my friend Eric who just, who wrote the movie Arrival. Did you see that?
Oh, wow.
Oh,
yeah,
my God. That movie was
awesome.
He just came out of Rogue.
You can take that call. No, you can put him on speaker. I liked Arrival a lot, too. I'd love to talk to Eric if he wants to join in.
I wouldn't spring that on him, but he just came out. And I said, call me the second you come out. I want to hear what you think. So I'm
and very, now you're big time in him. Sorry, I was on a very popular internet show.
Where was I? What was I saying? Oh, no! For the longest time, I mean, I remember, like, you know, I knew that I, you know, obviously knew for a long time that Vader was in the movie, but I, you know, like,
yeah,
this kind of, it's like you want to go, ah! But like they'll kill me.
Yeah, of course.
I mean, I can't. It's not, I'm a professional and I can keep secrets, and part of my ability to have this job rests on the fact that I can do that. If people can't trust me to keep secrets, I can't work.
Yeah.
And again, I don't like people who spoil movies. I don't want to be that guy, you know? And, so all of that, and again, just, and plus, I mean, they, you know, legally could string me up and like scatter my body parts of the, you know, four corners of the,
you signed the contract. This is what we said.
So you sit on it and, you know, and you don't tell, you know, and that's why part of what's so satisfying now is it's all there now. We can talk about Vader. Isn't that cool? Oh,
so good.
And we can say all these things because there's nothing left to spoil. Like for example, like for the longest time, I remember when I saw Chopper from Star Wars Rebels on set, the live action version, I was like, oh shit, Chopper's gonna be in the movie? That is the coolest shit I've ever seen. He has a little moment where he rolls, he's like, he's there, he's an Easter egg. And I can say it now because like people have spotted him. Like there's already articles like, here are all the Star Wars Easter eggs. And if you look at this particular moment, there's Chopper. So it's like, there's nothing left for me to spoil in the movie because you've all seen it. Mm-hmm. So we can just talk about it now. And it's like the most cathartic thing to be able to go, oh, we can talk about it now. And it's like holding your breath for 3 years and then finally be able to go, oh, and that's how it feels.
I love it. I love looking at your Twitter and just seeing you reply to literally everybody because you just want to talk about it so much. And it's like, so
I mean, you know, like I said, it's been overwhelmed. I honestly can't, I could not keep up with it. It was the first time in my life where I've had more tweets in my mentions than in my actual timeline because people are just tweeting at me.
Sure, sure.
And you know, it's easy to find me on Twitter and people have been responding. And again, 90% of my responses to people are, people saying like, I wasn't the only writer. Like, oh, you wrote a great movie. I'm like, no, I was one of the writers on a great movie. And you have to acknowledge John, who came up with the original idea, and many of the characters. And then you've got to acknowledge Chris, who created the characters that are in the movie, you know, certain movies. So yeah, I won't get into this, but like, there are characters in the movie that I had nothing to do with. They got added after I left as the movie developed and writers brought, you know, new ideas. And so it's really important to me because I feel like a total heel claiming credit for anything that I don't deserve.
For the record, I'm pretty sure if Nick was right when he was talking to me last night, you made the Death Star, right?
What do you mean?
That was your idea?
The Death Star?
Yeah,
I was five.
It was a great idea. Time's nothing.
But we did issue a patch. We did issue a patch for it. 40 years late, thermal exhaust port logic issue fixed.
You made. I think one of my favorite things is when it finally got announced that it was Rogue One and it was about the Death Star, you tweeted a photo of your rug at your desk.
I have a Death Star rug in my office, and for the longest time I couldn't even tweet that because when I first started working there, somebody at Lucasfilm said, like, just bear in mind, like, we understand you have a social media presence. Just bear in mind that anything, like they said, I remember they said, working here is like running for president. Anything you say is going to get picked apart analyzed and what did he mean when he said that? And so just be careful about what you say. So even something as like showing that I have a Death Star, right? I had a Death Star, one of the books that I had for reference when I was working, I had a Death Star technical manual. They literally made one of these, a technical manual for the Death Star that shows how the reactor system works and stuff. And I had that on my, it was one of my reference books, you know, because obviously, but I could never, I literally had to think about, like, if I took a picture, like, is that book in the frame? Is someone going to go zoom in, enhance, CSI?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, that's the kind of shit you got to think about, because this stuff is the commodity, the currency for, like, you know, rumors and leaks and things on something like this is so high that you've just got to be like, I was like way like ultra, way over the top careful. I went to the extremes that I probably did not have to go to.
You're like, I had to leave my wife for a year and a half.
We set up a prop office. Yeah. Fake walls, fake everything. Gary, thank
you so
much.
True Lies.
By.
You know, he goes to work. Oh,
he's like, here's
your
rent. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Some insurance now. Right, thank you. And then goes off and does something totally different.
They're like, Kevin Kennedy's like, you can wear your wedding ring. You don't have to give that to Tom Arnold every time you go over.
He's erasing his fingerprints, yeah, doing all the different stuff.
It's crazy.
Gary, you're the best. I'm happy for you.
Thank you. It's like I said, it's such a relief to see the movie out there and people like it. And it's just wonderful. Best experience of my life. I did one more. I was at a show last night, and this very sweet, white-haired, silver-haired lady came up to me.
Carrie Fisher.
And she was maybe, I'm 44, she was maybe anywhere between like 10, 15 years older than me. And she didn't look like a Star Wars fan on the surface, but she came up to me and said, and she was misty-eyed. And she said, I was in line for the original Star Wars, May 25th, 1977, I saw it first day. And she said, this movie made me feel like that day. And I got so, I got so choked up by it, because that was, you know, to be able to do that is the greatest gift in the world.
Great job, Gary. Great fucking job. Thank you so much for coming by today. Thank you for working on Rogue One.
I'm crying.
All right, I got to hug.
You're making me like crying.
This is the time now.
That's so cool.
Oh, my goodness. You can't put this possibly broadcast this.
We're putting that up. Oh, that's fuck you. That's internet gold, sir. Thank you for coming by, Gary.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for watching this and supporting us. Of course, while we've been talking here, the Patreon supporters for the month of November have been rolling by. Right, Kevin?
Yep.
Yeah, he's going to put it in there. It's like time manipulation stuff. Of course, but thank you for supporting us, obviously, throughout 2016. Remember, there's still more shows coming up. There's Game Over Greggy shows to close it out, but this is our final one that is being recorded for the year of 2016. Again, next week and the week after, still shows. Plenty of stuff happening. We're just going to be on vacation. Thank you for all of that. Remember, January 5th, 2017. It'll be Kind of Funny Day as usual. Come to twitch.tv/kindoffunnygames. See what 2017 is going to look like for us. Remember, you go to patreon.com/kindoffunny. Get every episode early. If you don't have any money or bucks to toss our way, no big deal. You can go to youtube.com/kindoffunny. Get the show topic by topic, day by day, and we'll put it up all as one big MP3 and video on Friday. Remember, this little film, Rogue One, A Star Wars Story, out now. Again, if it, I'm not trying to get ahead of myself. If it charts this weekend, if it does well at the box office,
you're welcome.
The best friends.
I think we've got
you.
A decent yeah. shot.
You know what? Well, now you do. You put in the work here.
Yes.
You cried
this
for
it. This is it.
Like, what else?
when this goes out on the Disney, like, wait, suddenly, what? Something's happening.
We got to trace back this spike we've yeah. seen if people yeah, yeah. wanted
What's
to go see
on?
This movie.
The movie suddenly, Fandango just went nuclear. What these people are just, like, people are kind of funny, and they're all going to Fandango, and like, there's this correlation. What is going on? This yep. could be very good for you.
Yeah, and this, you're going to look really good to them. They got yeah. a whole bunch of other stuff to write.
Yeah.
Get in one of the Marvel movies, huh?
I really, really want to do... Oh, so Kevin Feige came yeah. out of the premiere. He was there. I really want to do Squirrel Girl, the movie. That's
yes.
my thing.
Yeah?
Yes.
He came out and he walked out of the theater and he just said, that was amazing. That was amazing. I thought, now's the chance. Get him. I said, you like that? Maybe you like this. But I couldn't... He disappeared into
Damn
the crowd
it.
Before I could grab him.
Does he have a Twitter?
Yeah, it's yeah, yeah.
Kevin, put up the Twitter right now.
He follows me on Twitter, and I still can't get any love.
All right, here's what we're doing: put up the Twitter, and we will craft a message.
Don't spam.
Don't
his
do it.
Twitter.
Don't spam the Twitter. Don't spam his Twitter.
That's the
I mean,
last
they're
thing
best friends.
Need.
They're super nice.
You
I mean,
did that to Ruffalo last time.
I know, and it almost worked. We got him on board for the Columbo movie. Just not anyone who owns the rights.
Yes.
But we got him there. He's all set.
He was there.
Please don't spam.
Don't spam, Kevin. It'll all happen
do
on
not,
his own.
Do that. Just make my life more difficult.
Don't worry. And also, like, but maybe you could go write a DC movie and fix all that.
Maybe that could begin to set things right.
I don't know what DC Wonder Woman looks like. It'll be good.
Yeah, well,
I like the look of that. Yeah.
The trailers have gotten us before, though.
I don't like the, if you look at the DC characters, there aren't a lot of characters in the DC stable where I go, oh, I'd kill to write for that character. I don't think. I'm trying to think.
DC doesn't have a Squirrel Girl.
I mean, I do like Batman and Superman, but like, it's, I feel like we're struggling for things left to say with those characters. Or maybe it's just they're in such a dark place now, it's hard to imagine like how you bring them
back. You could bring them back to light, though.
I like 1978, was it 78? Richard Donner Superman. I like that.
Oh, yeah.
Like when the suit was actually blue. Yeah. It looks like it hadn't been washed in 10 years. You know, like dark blue and everything's super dark and it's raining all the time. Yeah. And so grim.
Some problems there. Yeah.
I went off in a meeting. I was pitching a movie. I can't remember where. And the subject of Superman. And I blew the whole pitch because I went on fanboy took over. I went, and another thing, Superman's an asshole now. What the fuck is that? I was like complaining about Superman, and again, like that's not what we're here.
Let me tell you about Popeyes.
Yeah, it's the last time Gary would have ever pitched Zack Snyder on anything.
Yeah, that's right. I'm not. Yeah, I mean, what can you? You know, I don't think it's any secret that I'm not a fan of those movies. I think Zack. I love a lot of his movies. I did not. Again, his take on those characters not
your take.
Not to my taste.
Understandably. All right. Understandably so.
All right.
Thank you, Gary. Thank you. Love you, Gary. Until next time, it's been our pleasure to serve you.